Lorraine, so you can hang on 1 second. There's a question in the chat whether the round number on the ballot, yes, is the final round. And I will put the team numbers in the chat for the judges. That's a great idea. 107 is prosecution. 116 is defense. All right. Before I start the live stream and we get moving, does anyone have any last minute questions, concerns, things you want to ask, things you want clarification on? Or are we good to go?
Defense is ready, Your Honor. No, sorry, not Your Honor. Phil?
Phil, Your Honor, I'm fine with either.
And prosecution's ready as well.
Awesome. All right, so I'm going to play our trailer and then we're going to get going.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
I know I'd go from rags to riches if you would only say you care. And though my pocket may be empty, I'd be a millionaire. My clothes may still be torn and tattered, but in my heart I'd be a king.
Welcome everyone to the 2021 Battle of the Experts final round. My name is Phil Pascarolo. I'm the trial competition director at the Drexel University Thomas R. Klein School of Law. And first off, let me just say thank you to everyone who's been involved with this tournament from the beginning of the weekend, all the 16 teams who put on just fantastic trials throughout the weekend, the almost 150 judges that came out virtually to our tournament and judged. And to everyone who's watching our live stream, tuning in for our final round, thank you so much. I'm really looking forward to seeing this championship round. We started back on Friday morning with 16 teams, not only 16 teams, but 16 of the top trial advocacy programs in the country. And now we're down to the final two to figure out who's going to be the fourth annual Battle of the Experts national champion. And so before we get going, if I could have all the competitors turn their video off and the judges turn their videos on. And before I introduce our panel here, I think there are a couple of spectators in the Zoom. I would just ask that you sign out of the Zoom and watch the round live on our YouTube page. You can watch the stream live on YouTube. You don't need to be in the Zoom room. We can't have any spectators in the Zoom room, unfortunately. And Joe, can I have you turn your video on also? Thank you. So I want to start with our presiding judge, Joe Lester. Joe is the Associate Director of Advocacy Training and Competitions at the American University Washington College of Law. Before joining American last year, Joe was the Director of Advocacy Programs for more than a decade at Faulkner University's Jones School of Law. Joe has coached more than 30 teams to regional championships and 20 teams that advanced to national final competitions. Joe also created and maintains trialteamcentral.org, which is the most highly regarded source for anything law school, mock trial, tournament results, standings, all that sort of thing. Joe's website is the central hub for that. And so we're really excited to have Joe presiding over our final round. Next, our scoring judges. We'll start with Ashley DiMuzio. Ashley is a public defender in North Carolina. Ashley competed on several of Wake Forest Law's national trial teams, including the 2018 Tournament of Champions hosted by Drexel Klein. She was on their national championship TOC team, and Ashley was named the best advocate of the tournament. Ashley also competed on two of Wake Forest's AAJ teams, where her team finished as regional finalist. Most recently, Ashley represented Wake Forest as their 2019 Top Gun at Baylor's yearly one-on-one competition, recognizing the top 16 advocates in the country. And she's now a coach at Wake Forest of their trial team. Next, Lorraine Donnelly. Lorraine is a trial attorney and my colleague at Client Inspector, where she represents catastrophically injured plaintiffs and where she's earned millions of dollars in settlements for her clients. Before joining Client Inspector, Lorraine was an assistant district attorney in Philadelphia for 10 years. Lorraine has tried almost 100 jury trials, including 40 homicide trials. And so Lorraine's expertise is going to be especially important in this trial. Next, Jordan Freeman. Jordan is a public defender in Philadelphia, where he's tried many, many jury trials and a handful of homicide trials. So just like Lorraine, we're really excited to have someone with Jordan's experience level judging our final round. And I'm even prouder to say that Jordan is one of the coaches of Drexel Klein's national trial teams. Next, Paul Kaufman. Paul Kaufman is an assistant United States attorney for the Eastern District of Pennsylvania. Now, I mean this with no pun intended at all, but Paul is one of the godfathers of mock trial in Philadelphia. For years, Paul has coordinated high school mock trial in Pennsylvania and in Philadelphia, including when I was a high school student. And he is the chair of the National High School Mock Trial Championships, the organization that's responsible for coordinating and supporting high school mock trial for literally thousands of students across the country. Next, Vargis Kurion is an assistant district attorney in Philadelphia. He was for the first 7 years of his career and returned to his roots in 2018, came back to the DA's office in Philly. During his decade at the DA's office, Vargis has tried, I'd say, too many cases probably for him to count. And for the last 2 years, he's been an adjunct at the Klein School of Law, where he teaches trial ad and evidence. And last but not least, Fred Perry. And before I get into Fred's very brief bio, I think the thing that I could say that would explain why I'm so excited to have Fred judging our final round is when we signed him to the Zoom, Lorraine private messaged me and said, I can't believe you got Fred Perry to judge the final round. If I ever murdered someone, Fred would be the first person I would call to defend me. So I think that's probably the highest compliment you can get, Fred. Fred's a trial attorney, former assistant district attorney in Philadelphia, the founding partner of McMonagle Perry, where he represents clients in criminal and civil matters. Fred's been a trial attorney for 30 years. During that time, he's obtained hundreds of acquittals and millions of dollars in verdicts and settlements for his civil clients. And for that reason, Fred's been named a super lawyer in Pennsylvania for every year since 2005. With those introductions, I want to just say thank you one more time to our amazing scoring panel. Our judges can turn their cameras and microphones off now. And once all the judges do that, I will turn it over to our presiding judge, Lester, to get the trial started. Go ahead, Joe.
All right. Welcome, everybody. This is actually the second time I've judged the final or presided at the final round of the Battle of the Experts. I don't know if that's an honor, because that means I'm a coach that gets to do this, but it also means that my team is not competing in this for two times out of the times that we've competed. So I'm super jealous of you guys for being here and proud of you and looking forward to a great round. Is everybody here? I think everybody is here. Can we go ahead and get started? We'll call the case of Commonwealth of Pennsylvania versus Thomas Santasuso. Scoring judges, just as a reminder, if you'll please look to the two buttons on your lower left of screen and turn your audio and video off, make sure those are off, which they are, and they should remain off until the trial ends. And you should have a video set to hide all non-video participants. That'll get rid of all the boxes. And that means only the people on the screen right now should be the advocates and me. You can also change your settings to gallery view and speaker view. We'd recommend that you change it to speaker view during their open and closes and a gallery view during the directs and crosses. That being said, let's get appearances from the Commonwealth.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. Mallory Sonnenblum on behalf of the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. My name is Raymond Rafel, and I also represent the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. And when appropriate, Your Honor, we do have some housekeeping matters we would like to address with the court.
All right, sounds good. Let's get appearances from defense counsel.
Good afternoon, Your Honor. My name is Sarah Stebbins, and I'm joined today by my co-counsel, Mr. Seth Wax.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
We represent the defendant in today's case, Mr. Thomas Santasusa.
All right. Commonwealth mentioned that you had some housekeeping matters. Let's go and address this.
Yes, Your Honor. There is a joint exhibit list where the exhibits are marked for identification numerically. Is the court comfortable with us entering these exhibits into evidence as they're previously marked?
That's fine with me. Is that okay with defense counsel?
Absolutely, Your Honor. That's fine with us.
All right.
And for impeachment purposes, would Your Honor like us to share our screen with the witness's sworn statements, or shall we presume the witness has a copy of their sworn statement in front of them?
Let's presume they have a copy in front of them. Unless they indicate they don't, then in that case, you can share the screen.
Yes, Your Honor. And for the purposes of the trial today, may we argue sidebars constructively?
You can. You'll just need, when you want a sidebar, you'll need to ask for a sidebar.
Yes, Your Honor. And shall we presume the witnesses have already been sworn in?
Yes, we will.
At this time, Your Honor, the prosecution seeks to constructively invoke the rule of sequestration under Federal Rule of Evidence 615, excluding the defendant, of course.
Any objection to that by the defense counsel?
No objection, Your Honor. We would, however, like our expert in today's case, Ms. Mac Ledesma, to remain present pursuant to 615C. We have no issue excluding the other witnesses.
Is Commonwealth okay with the defense maintaining their expert?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, so we'll just exclude the Commonwealth's witnesses. All right. Any other housekeeping?
Yes, Your Honor. One last one. Due to the limitations of holding this hearing through Zoom, we would just like to bring to the court's attention to the fact that my co-counsel and I will be communicating through the private chat function, just to avoid confusion with the possible appearance of distraction.
You do what you need to do. All right, any additional housekeeping matters from the defense?
Yes, Your Honor, just one more. A question about your preferences given today's Zoom format. Would you like us to ask permission each time to share our screens when we ask to publish things to the jury? Or may we assume that with the court's permission to publish also includes permission to use the share screen function?
I think you can assume that the permission to publish means permission to share screen. So we can just make it efficient as possible.
Excuse me, Your Honor. And does Your Honor have a copy of the electronic case packet in today's case?
I do, yes.
Perfect. With that, we're ready to move on to motions.
All right. Commonwealth, do you have any motions in limine?
We do, Your Honor. However, we did also have an opportunity to meet with defense counsel pre-trial and come to some stipulations in this matter.
All right. What are the agreements? Would you like to discuss the agreements, or do you just want to take them up as they occur during the trial?
If the court's comfortable with it, Your Honor, we'd like to make the court aware of the agreements we've come to.
All right. You may proceed.
We have agreed to exclude Exhibit 6 from today's trial, with the exception of the charge for possession with intent to sell on Mr. Nick Patrick's criminal history. However, Your Honor, we have agreed that the first four charges will be excluded, and we have agreed that the crime of dishonesty, that is theft on this exhibit, is permissible under Federal Rule of Evidence 609. However, prosecution would seek to exclude as well the charge for possession with intent to sell.
Okay, so is that all part of the agreement, or is that part of the agreement and part motion?
The agreement, Your Honor, is that the first four charges will be excluded and that the crime of dishonesty, that is theft, will be included.
All right. Is that the defense counsel's understanding of the agreement?
Yes, Your Honor. And just to clarify, we don't necessarily have agreement about the document Exhibit 6. The agreement is as to those specific charges, like opposing counsel mentioned. The defense does have argument on that motion as to the first possession charge, which is the last one on that sheet. And we understand that the theft charge will be included as well.
Okay. All right. So noted. I'm a little confused. Is there a ruling here that you want me to make, or are we just going on? Okay. So are you moving to exclude the charge for possession?
Yes, Your Honor, that is correct.
Okay. And what grounds?
Your Honor, any mention of or evidence relating to this charge under Federal Rule of Evidence 609A1A would as well be subject to the balancing test of Federal Rule of Evidence 403. In this case, Your Honor, this charge does not surpass this balancing test, as any effect that it would have on today's trial would be far more prejudicial than it would have any probative value to offer.
May I be heard, Your Honor?
You may.
Yes, Your Honor. This charge concerns Commonwealth witness Nick Patrick. He's a government informant, and he's testifying here today as part of a plea deal. Under Rule 609A, this charge was punishable by more than 1 year in prison, so it must be admitted subject to that 403 test that opposing counsel just mentioned. This is not substantially more prejudicial as it is probative, Your Honor, as there will be evidence in today's case that Mr. Patrick was part of the mob and that his mob boss had specifically threatened him that if he caught him dealing drugs again, he would kill him. As a result of that threat, Your Honor, it's the defense's contention that Mr. Patrick accepted his plea agreement with the state. And furthermore, it's the defense's contention that that threat goes to Mr. Patrick's own motivations in killing Mr. Caffiero himself. Your Honor, this witness is here on a plea agreement, and the jury has the right to evaluate his credibility in light of the agreement the state reached with him. And that means this charge is not more prejudicial than it is probative and should be admitted subject to 609A.
So is this a conviction or just a charge?
It's a conviction, Your Honor. Excuse me.
Okay.
Delay in the Zoom, Your Honor. It's a conviction.
All right. Any response from the Commonwealth?
Yes, Your Honor. This charge for possession with intent to sell is not a crime of dishonesty. Additionally, Your Honor, this means that it would not go to the witness's credibility in today's case. Your Honor, we ask that in the alternative, if you find that this charge would have more this conviction, excuse me, would have more of a probative value in today's trial than it would a prejudicial effect, we ask that you limit the entrance of this testimony or evidence relating to this conviction to simply the mention that he was convicted of a felony. Your Honor, the terms heroin and any specific amount referring to that conviction as well would absolutely have a prejudicial effect on Nick Patrick and today's trial, Your Honor, as those terms would shock and inflame the passions of the jury.
May be heard on those grounds, Your Honor?
You may.
Your Honor, the fact that it's a heroin charge or that it's a drug charge is actually specifically probative to today's case. And as mentioned, that's because Nick Patrick was in the mob. That won't be disputed today. And because he was in the mob, his mob boss had specifically told him he would not be permitted to sell drugs upon penalty of death. That means this goes directly to his credibility, Your Honor, in specifically his credibility in taking that plea deal from the state. That's why he's here today. That's why he's testifying. That's why he's cooperating. That's why he's providing the state with their evidence. That does not make this substantially more prejudicial than it is probative.
Okay. From what I'm hearing, it sounds like the defense counsel wants to use this not under a 609 character for truthfulness, but to attack the bias of the witness in the deal that they received. And so I'm going to overrule that motion. Any other motions from the Commonwealth?
Yes, Your Honor. At this time, prosecution would also seek to exclude the document from being entered into evidence that is Nick Patrick's cooperation agreement and any mention of or evidence relating to the details and specifics of this agreement. Your Honor, while we understand it is relevant to today's trial that Mr. Patrick entered into this agreement that he and his family stand to gain a substantial benefit for his truthful testimony, any further details and specifics would not have a probative value on today's trial. Additionally, Your Honor, one of these details and specifics is the pending charge for possession with intent to sell of an illegal substance. Your Honor, under Federal Rules of Evidence 609, this is used for convictions to be used for the purposes of impeachment. Your Honor, the use of this pending charge under such rule would be improper, as it does not give leeway for pending charges or cooperation agreements.
May I be heard, Your Honor?
You may.
Your Honor, similar to the argument from just a moment ago, this goes directly to Nick Patrick's credibility. And first, one thing to clarify is per that plea agreement, Mr. Patrick has been charged. He has not yet been sentenced, but the first paragraph of that plea agreement details that he has already been charged with that crime. Your Honor, there will be no dispute today that Mr. Patrick was arrested with nearly 700 grams of heroin in his car. The state reached this plea deal with Mr. Patrick, and it is certainly probative that the jury get to hear what the terms of that plea deal are. Your Honor, that's the reason he's here testifying. That goes directly to his credibility, and he's the state's key witness in today's case. That certainly is not more prejudicial than it is probative.
And by charge, do you mean has pled guilty?
Your Honor, the specifics of the plea agreement are that the Commonwealth has charged him with possession with intent to distribute. Mr. Patrick admits that if tried for the aforementioned crime, he would be convicted. He has not yet been sentenced, as this whole plea agreement is pending his truthful testimony in today's case.
Okay. All right. Since this is a key witness and their credibility is going to be an issue at trial, I'm going to overrule that motion. Any other motions that we have?
No additional motions from the prosecution, Your Honor. However, I believe defense counsel will bring to the court's attention some other agreements we were able to come to.
Absolutely, Your Honor.
Defense counsel?
Yes, Your Honor. I'd like to read two substantive stipulations onto the record now that we reached during our meeting for.
All right.
Stipulation one, both parties agree to exclude all evidence regarding monikers and aliases of Mr. Santasuso.
Okay.
And stipulation number two, both parties agree to exclude all evidence of Mr. Santasuso's prior criminal record set forth in Exhibit 5.
Right. So we're going to exclude the defendant's criminal record? Is that?
Yes, Your Honor, and any evidence of said criminal record.
All right. Is the Commonwealth, is that an accurate statement? Does the Commonwealth agree that Mr. Wax's statement is accurate?
Yes, Your Honor, as it pertains to any evidence and criminal record contained in that exhibit.
Okay. Any further motions from the defense?
No, Your Honor, without the defense is ready to proceed to opening statements.
All right. Well, then let's move to opening statements. Commonwealth, you go first.
One, two, three. 3 seconds to think, 3 seconds to plan, and 3 seconds to act. That's what the defendant had. That's what the defendant counted to right before he stabbed William Cafiero in the heart on June 11th, 2019. But that day, the defendant had so much more than just those 3 seconds to reflect. The evidence will show that the defendant had at least 3 separate opportunities to reflect on his actions. But this story starts long before that day. So let's travel back, way back to the 1930s. In Italy, a huge group of criminals come together and La Cosa Nostra is born. A huge crime family that runs illegal enterprises like gambling, prostitution rings, fraud, even murder. Eventually, this crime family disperses just physically, with smaller branch families moving to places like the US. But La Cosa Nostra doesn't disperse in ties. We'll hear today that even now, La Cosa Nostra is still one big deadly family made up of 100% Italian blood. Now, two of these branch families that I mentioned are the Battaglia family and the Montanari family. They move to the US and they keep on going all the way up until 2019, where we all know them as the Mafia, where the evidence will show that the defendant, Thomas Santasuso, is an associate for the Battaglia crime family. We'll hear evidence today that from as far back as he can remember, the defendant always wanted to be a gangster. We'll hear that associates like the defendant are the bottom of the mafia barrel, the lowest of the low mafia ranks. They're not typically made because they can't trace their roots 100% back to Italy. So they don't get formally initiated. They don't get an extra coat of protection and respect from the mafia. But we'll also hear today that that same blood that formed La Cosa Nostra back in Italy runs through the defendant's veins. So why was he just an associate? Why wasn't the defendant made? You'll learn today, the defendant thought it was a who that was holding him back from being made. You'll learn he thought it was the victim, William Cafiero. That brings us to June 11th, 2019, at the Bamboo Lounge, where as usual, the Montanari family and the Battaglia family are drinking, smoking, fighting, and Mr. Cafiero has just gotten out of jail. We'll hear about how, as members of separate crime families often do, Mr. Cafiero was giving the defendant a hard time, mocking him even. And of course, we'll hear about how this blew up into a full-blown altercation, We'll hear about how the defendant then storms out of the lounge in rage. We'll hear about that altercation, and we'll hear about how that rage stays with the defendant from the moment he storms out of that lounge all the way up until the moment that he is digging Mr. Cafiero's grave. Now, Nick Patrick, the defendant's co-associate, will get the chance to talk to us today. And when he does, he'll tell us just what happened next, about how after he storms out of the lounge in rage, the defendant makes Mr. Patrick keep Mr. Cafiero at the lounge, awaiting the defendant's return, and ultimately awaiting his own murder. Mr. Patrick will take us step by step through the beating, stuffing, gagging, driving, and stabbing that the defendant had him help with. But members of the jury, we understand that at first glance, Mr. Patrick might not be so easy to trust. After all, he was involved in this crime. The defendant's partner in this crime, if you will. And so he is here by cooperation agreement. But when you're looking at a mafia murder, there just are no perfect witnesses. That's why today we'll also hear from Sergeant Lynn Rausch, the homicide investigator who had to uncover every brutal step of this crime. She'll walk us through the forensic evidence she collected. She'll confirm that, unfortunately, Mr. Cafiero is dead. She'll confirm that the knife the defendant used to do it was from the defendant's mother's house, where the evidence will show you the defendant conveniently stops by earlier that evening. Sergeant Rausch is going to show us just how Nick Patrick and the evidence in this case show us the exact same thing, that the defendant killed William Cafiero on June 11th, 2019. But I want to take a break from this story for a moment to talk to you about the law. After all, it's what you have to consider today. First degree murder, like the defendant's been charged with, requires premeditation. This is a period of reflection. But under the law, there is no time requirement for this reflection to occur. Could happen in just a few seconds. It could happen as fast as 1, 2, 3. But we'll hear today about all the other time the defendant had to reflect before he killed William Cafiero. Now, as the Commonwealth, it's Mr. Raful and I's job today to prove three things to you: that Mr. Cafiero was dead, that the defendant killed him, and that he thought about it first. We have to prove those things to you beyond a reasonable doubt. The members of the jury, we gladly accept this burden, because all it means is that at the end of today's trial, we can't leave you with any reasonable doubt in your mind. So we won't, because when you go back into deliberation, you'll remember 1, 2, 3. But until then, we have a story to finish. Mr. Patrick will tell us how when the defendant returns to the lounge, he has Mr. Patrick and Mr. Cafiero waiting in the alley, a place with no light, no witnesses, and no mercy. You'll learn this is the time the defendant's rage finally comes out. You'll learn it's when he begins to beat Mr. Cafiero, punching, kicking, and smashing his skull into the concrete alley ground. A beating so severe that the evidence will show the men were able to wrap his beaten, broken, and bleeding body into a sheet and throw it right into the trunk of Mr. Patrick's car. Finally, we'll hear about how after they drive to the defendant's mother's house, grab a knife and a shovel, and make it to the open field behind the Primrose Diner, yet another place with no light, no escape for Mr. Cafiero, and no mercy, the defendant and Mr. Patrick get out of the car, and they hear what could only be one thing: Mr. Cafiero, still alive, just barely, squirming and banging in that trunk where he lay helpless, begging to keep his life. Members of the jury, this is when we'll hear that the defendant has the ultimate reflection. And he makes the ultimate choice. That's why we're confident that at the end of today's trial, you'll find the defendant guilty of first-degree murder. Because members of the jury, when he hears that, what could only be Mr. Cafiero, he walks around to the trunk of that car. The defendant locks eyes with Mr. Patrick, knife in hand, and he counts out loud, 1, 2, 3. Thank you.
Thank you, defense counsel. You wish to make an opening statement?
Yes, Your Honor.
You may proceed whenever you're ready.
It was his only way out. It's February 2018, inside a bar. Customers are getting a drink with their friends after work. They're laughing and joking around, enjoying the evening. But in the back room, nobody's laughing. Because Nick Patrick isn't getting a drink. He's getting a warning. His mob boss looms over him. He feels the grip on his shirt collar as he gets in his face. Stop dealing drugs. Because next time, there won't be a next time. Less than a year later, Nick Patrick is arrested with almost a kilo of heroin in his car. And he's not worried about a prison sentence from the state. He's worried about a death sentence from the mob. He knows that if he walks out those police precinct doors, the mob will kill him for selling drugs. If he goes to prison, the mob has people on the inside who will kill him for selling drugs. And not just him, his wife, his two little girls. The evidence will show there was only one way Nick Patrick could avoid a mafia death sentence. You'll learn today that Mr. Patrick didn't point the finger at Thomas Santasusso because it was true. The evidence will show he accused Mr. Santasusso of murder because it was his only way out. And members of the jury, I want to be clear. We as the defense, we aren't disputing that Nick Patrick was involved with this crime. But it's the Commonwealth's burden to prove to you today, beyond a reasonable doubt, that Thomas Santasusso was there with him. And that Thomas Santasusso was the one who actually killed Billy Cafiero. And they're going to fail to meet that burden. They're going to fail, members of the jury, for three reasons. First, the Commonwealth's entire case comes down to one eyewitness. Second, the evidence will show that eyewitness can't be trusted. And third, you'll learn the forensic evidence contradicts that eyewitness. So let's take this one at a time. Starting with the first, the Commonwealth's entire case comes down to one eyewitness. Opposing counsel just got up here and she told you the story of a bar fight gone horribly wrong. It's a story where Billy Cafiero and Thomas Santasusso have an argument and Thomas Santasusso loses his temper. That's true. Billy Cafiero and Thomas Santasusso got into an argument. But it's also undisputed what happened next. Thomas Santasusso left. There's only one witness who will tell you today that Thomas Santasuso ever came back to that bar. Only one witness who will tell you Mr. Santasuso ever attacked Billy Cafiero. Only one witness who will ever put a weapon in Mr. Santasuso's hands. That person is Nick Patrick. The Commonwealth just got up here and they told you that he's their eyewitness. What they didn't tell you is that he's their only eyewitness. Which brings us to that second point. The evidence will show that eyewitness can't be trusted. You're going to hear from a bartender in today's case named Lee Simple. He was working at the Bamboo Lounge the night of the murder, and he's going to tell you about a conversation that he overheard between Nick Patrick and Nick Patrick's mob boss. He's going to tell you he saw that boss grab Mr. Patrick by the collar, get in his face, and make him a promise. If I catch you dealing drugs again, you're dead. A former FBI investigator named Mac Ledesma will also take the stand today. She's an expert in mafia discipline and mafia organization. And she's going to tell you that that threat was real. She's going to tell you that the mob doesn't like dealing drugs. And if Nick Patrick had been caught dealing drugs again and gone back to his normal life, he could have been killed. If he had gone to prison, the mob has people on the inside, and he could have been killed. You'll learn there was only one way for Nick Patrick to avoid that mafia death sentence. You'll learn that this was his only way out. Which brings us to that third point. The forensic evidence will contradict their eyewitness. You see, Nick Patrick's going to tell you today that Thomas Santasuso got covered in blood as he was beating the victim. Their detective will tell you there was no blood on Thomas Santasuso's clothes. Mr. Patrick will tell you Mr. Santasuso got into his car, Nick Patrick's car, covered in blood. Their detective will tell you there was no forensic evidence, no blood, no fingerprints, no hairs to link Mr. Santasuso to ever being inside that car. Nick Patrick will tell that Mr. Santasuso held the murder weapon in his hand. But their detective will tell you there's no forensic evidence, no fingerprints, no blood that link Mr. Santasuso to that knife at all. Members of the jury, today there will be no doubt about who Nick Patrick is. He's a mobster. He's a gangster. He's a felon. And he's the Commonwealth's star witness. He's the Commonwealth's only eyewitness. And today the evidence will show that Mr. Patrick didn't accuse Mr. Santasuso of murder because it was true. The evidence will show he accused him because it was his only way out. That's why at the end of this trial, my co-counsel, Seth Wax, will come before you and ask that you find Mr. Santasuso not guilty. Thank you.
Thank you. Commonwealth, will you call your first witness?
Before we do that, Your Honor, we do have a few stipulations and pretrial orders, as well as a clarification we would like to read onto the record.
All right, you may proceed.
Beginning with pretrial orders number 9 and 10, Your Honor. Number 9 states exhibits 15 and 29 are pre-admitted. Number 10 states the defendant has consented to a trial by Zoom. No objections to the Zoom format on constitutional grounds or otherwise will be entertained. And beginning with the stipulations on page 6, stipulation number 6 states The closest cell tower to the Bamboo Lounge is three blocks away at 3400 Walnut Street, Siena, Pennsylvania. And number 11 states, as of the time of trial, Mac Ledesma has worked for 26 hours on this case, which includes review of materials, creation of an expert report, and preparation for trial. And lastly, Your Honor, clarification number 14 states, for purposes of identification, we may assume the defendant has turned on his video and is wearing a gray suit with a blue tie.
So noted for the record.
Thank you, Your Honor. At this time, we would like to call Nick Patrick to the stand.
All right, Nick Patrick, you are pre-sworn. Raful is going to ask you some questions. You may begin whenever you're ready.
Good afternoon. Please state your name for the jury and spell your last name for the record.
Good afternoon. My name is Nick Patrick. It's spelled P-A-T-R-I-C-K.
Mr. Patrick, tell us about yourself.
I'm 35 years old. I've most recently been living in Siena, Pennsylvania with my beautiful wife and our son and two daughters.
And what do you do for work?
Well, right now I'm not doing anything, but I used to make money through the Battaglia crime family, running card games and stuff like that for them.
Now, who is that you just mentioned?
The Battaglia family is a crime family that runs the Siena area of Pennsylvania. It's not a real family, but everyone in it has Italian blood and everyone has their own rank.
Can you explain what some of the ranks are?
Of course, there's a chain of command. So at the top, you have the boss, below him an underboss or a consigliere, and then multiple captains with soldiers and associates who report to them.
Okay, so what rank were you?
I was an associate, you know, low-level guy, but that's because I'm not full Italian. I worked under Paul Ivaca and his crew, but again, I don't affiliate with the Battaglia family anymore ever since what happened on June 11th.
Well, is that why you're testifying today?
It is. A few days after June 11th, I got into some trouble and I was brought in by Sergeant Roush for questioning. And while I was there, they offered me an agreement.
No. For clarification, who offered you the agreement?
The Commonwealth of Pennsylvania did.
And what kind of agreement was it?
Well, it's a cooperation agreement. As long as I testified truthfully about everything I witnessed on June 11th, then they would keep me and my family safe from La Cosa Nostra.
Well, Mr. Patrick, why would your family be in danger?
Well, just by testifying here today or even just speaking to outsiders about La Cosa Nostra, you violate Omerta, which is our code of silence. And if you break Omerta, then La Cosa Nostra will start looking for you. And if they can't find you, then they'll look for your family.
So where are you right now?
Currently, I'm in witness protection.
What about your family?
I'd rather not say exactly where they are because, you know, La Cosa Nostra has ears everywhere, but I'll say that they're safe.
Okay. So let's talk about June 11th. What happened that night?
I witnessed a murder.
Well, who was killed?
William Cafiero was.
And who killed him?
Thomas Santasuso did.
Is Thomas Santasuso in this courtroom today?
Yeah, he's in here.
Can you identify Thomas Santasuso by an article of clothing?
I can. He's wearing a gray suit and a blue tie.
Let the record reflect the witness has identified the defendant.
All right. The record was noted and it was part of the pretrial stipulation, so no further identification is necessary.
Thank you, sir. Now, Mr. Patrick, how do you know the defendant?
I've known him for a long time. He's been a good friend of mine, and we worked together as associates under Paul Ivaca.
And did you talk to the defendant on June 11th?
I did. We texted during the day, and then I saw him later on at the Bamboo Lounge that night.
How did you know it was the defendant?
It was the same number he always uses. And since, you know, he's my good friend, we text pretty often. So, and he told me that he was going to the Bamboo Lounge at around 7:30, and that's when I saw him there.
Okay. And why did you go to the Bamboo Lounge?
We were going to see Billy.
What time did you get there?
I got there a little after 7 o'clock.
And when you got there, who all was there?
When I got there, it was just Billy, one of his associates, Jerry, and myself.
Now, Mr. Patrick, I just want to clarify, you've mentioned Billy. Who is that?
I'm sorry, Billy is William Cafiero. That's his nickname, and that's how I know him. Okay.
And did anyone come after you got there?
Yes, Thomas Santasuso and his wife got there a little after I did.
And while you were all at the lounge, what did you do?
We were hanging out. catching up, everything was great until Tommy and Billy started going at each other.
Now, Mr. Patrick, what do you mean by going at each other?
Well, I mean, they started fighting. I don't really know how else to put that.
Well, can you tell us what happened?
They were screaming insults at each other across the bar. Tommy threw his drink at Billy and he started charging towards him. But luckily I was able to step in and I stopped Tommy before anything got too serious.
What happened after you stepped in?
Things were still pretty heated between them. So Tommy left the Bamboo Lounge with his wife shortly after that.
Do you know exactly what time the defendant left?
He wasn't there for long, so he left around 8 o'clock that night.
Okay. And how long did you stay after that?
Well, I stayed and had a few drinks to catch up with Billy. And then I got a call from Tommy around 9:15, and he asked me to bring our friend from Jersey outside to the alley.
Who's your friend from Jersey?
Well, it had to be Billy Caffiero. He's the only one from Jersey there at the bar that night.
Okay. And what else did the defendant tell you on the phone?
Well, while I was on the phone, he said that he wanted to talk to Billy outside in the alley.
What actually happened when you walked into the alley?
Oh, right when we turned the corner, Tommy immediately jumped on Billy. I mean, he was kicking him, punching him, smashing his head into the pavement over and over again. And I'm not proud of it, but I kicked Billy a few times too, right at the beginning. But it got to the point where I had to eventually pull Tommy off of him.
Well, why do you say you had to pull the defendant off?
Well, I don't know if you've ever seen someone that you know personally be beaten to death and just continue to get their head smashed in, even after they're defenseless on the ground. But it hits a certain point where you just can't take it anymore and you have to do something.
Well, Mr. Patrick, you say beaten to death. Was William Caffiero dead?
No, it looked like he was, but I was able to see that he was still breathing.
Okay, so what happened after that?
Well, after the beating, Tommy picked Billy up and he threw him into the trunk of my car. And Tommy suggested that we take his body to the abandoned field behind the Primrose Diner.
And do you know what time exactly you left that alley?
We left around 10 o'clock.
And where'd you go?
Well, we were making our way to the Primrose Diner, but first we stopped by Tommy's mom's house on the way.
Why?
We went there to grab a knife and a shovel.
Okay. And what time did you leave the defendant's mother's house?
Well, we were there for a little bit. By the time we left, it was around 11 o'clock.
And then where'd you go?
Then we actually went to the abandoned field behind the Primrose Diner.
Do you know what time it was when you got there?
It's only a few blocks away from Tommy's mom's house, so we got there a few minutes after 11 o'clock.
Okay. And when you got there, was there anyone else at that diner?
No. At that point, it was closed, and it was really dark there anyway, so you can't really see much. And there's also a large fence between the abandoned field and the Primrose Diner, so no one else was there.
So what happened when you finally got through that fence?
I turned the car off, and Tommy and I got out. And then I started to hear these noises coming from my trunk, like, you know, banging against the hood of my car, muffled shouting, stuff like that.
What was it?
Well, the sounds were coming from my trunk, and Billy was the only one in there, so it had to be him.
So what did you do when you heard all of that?
Well, I looked over at Tommy, and we both just stood there for a little while. And then Tommy pulled out the knife that he took from his mom's house.
Did you get a good look at that knife?
I did. I mean, he pulled it out while he was standing right next to me.
And can you describe it for us?
Yeah, it was a chef's knife with a kind of curved black handle at the top. It had a silver blade. There were three silver dots on the side. And I remember the blade being noticeably larger than the handle.
Okay. Referring opposing counsel to what has been previously marked as Exhibit 12A for identification purposes, Mr. Patrick, please turn to page 32 of the trial packet you've been provided and let me know when you get there.
Okay, I'm there.
Do you recognize this?
Yes.
How do you recognize this?
I've seen this before.
And what is this you're looking at?
This is a picture of the same type of knife that Tommy took from his mom's house.
Is this a fair and accurate representation of the type of knife the defendant took from his mother's house on June 11th?
Yes, it is.
Your Honor, at this time, prosecution moves into evidence what has been previously marked as Exhibit 12A for identification purposes as prosecution's Exhibit 12A.
Any objection?
That objection, Your Honor.
All right, hearing no objection, I'll enter.
Thank you, Your Honor. Mr. Patrick, please let me know when you're able to see my screen.
Okay, I can see it now.
So what happened after the defendant took this knife out?
Well, he looked over at me and he gestured his head towards the trunk and he started to count out loud. 1, 2, 3, and I opened the trunk and we saw Billy laying there covered in his own blood.
Now, you mentioned that Billy was making noise. When you opened the trunk, was he still making noise?
He was.
What was he saying?
Started saying, "Tommy, please, no, Tommy, I've known you my whole life, please," you know, anything like that to save himself.
And what did the defendant say back to William Cafiero?
Nothing. He just started stabbing Billy.
How many times?
Stabbed him like 5 or 6 times right in the heart.
And what happened to William Cafiero after that?
After Tommy finished stabbing him, we buried him in the field and we left.
Now, Mr. Patrick, why didn't you tell anyone about that?
Well, I was scared. And if I did tell anyone, I was scared that I'd end up just like Billy, dead in that field.
No further questions.
Cross-examination?
Yes, Your Honor. A moment to readjust my camera.
You may.
May I proceed?
You may.
Good afternoon, Mr. Patrick. Can you see and hear me all right?
Good afternoon, Ms. Evans. Yes, I can hear you.
Mr. Patrick, you're part of the mob.
Well, I don't associate with the mob anymore. I did used to, though.
You were a soldier in the Battaglia crime family. Isn't that true?
No, that's not true. I was an associate in the Battaglia crime family.
A soldier, Mr. Patrick. You were a soldier in the Battaglia crime family.
Well, actually, soldiers require
that's full. Your Honor, ask an answer.
Over. Just to answer your question, soldiers require full Italian blood. That's why I was an associate, because I'm half Irish.
You were an associate in the Battaglia crime family, sir.
Yes, Ms. Evans.
You're also a convicted felon, right?
I am.
In the last 10 years, you've been convicted of 2 felonies.
I have.
That doesn't include your 2019 charge for possession of heroin with the intent to distribute, does it?
No, it does not.
That was for the drugs you were arrested for as part of today's case.
Well, they weren't involving the murder, if that's what you're saying.
That was for the heroin you were arrested with by Sergeant Roush before today's case. Is that correct?
Yes, it was before today's case, yes.
And that also doesn't involve any of the charges related to Billy Cafiero's murder, right?
Well, I don't have any pending charges with involving this murder.
That's a yes to my question, and that doesn't include any charges related to Billy Cafiero's murder, right?
Yes.
That's a murder that you admit you participated in, like you just told us, right?
Yes, I did.
I want to talk some more about the story you just told the jury. Mr. Patrick, that's not the first time you've told that story, is it?
No, I've had to repeat the story a couple of times.
Well, sir, every time you've told that story, it's changed. Isn't that true?
I do my best to tell the story as truthfully as I can every time, but there has been a lot of time that's passed between, you know, the murder and now. So if I make any mistakes, I do apologize.
Is that a yes? Every time you've told it, it's changed?
Yes, if you say there are some discrepancies, I might have misspoken on between one or two storytellings. So I apologize.
Let's talk about some of those. A minute ago, you told the members of the jury, I wrote it down to be sure I got it right. You said you kicked Billy a few times. Isn't that true?
Yes, I'm not proud of that.
Mr. Patrick, you were interviewed by the police.
Yes.
The police asked you what you were doing while Billy Caffiero was being beaten, right?
Yes.
You said you were stunned, just watching, right?
I was stunned. When I walked out with Billy out of the Bamboo Lounge, I was not expecting what happened to, you know, have happened.
Said a yes to my question, Mr. Patrick. You never mentioned that you were beating him too, did you?
I just mentioned it in this retelling, this, you know, retelling of it. So I'm not sure which time you're referring to when I was speaking about this.
When you talked to the police, sir, the first time they interviewed you, you didn't mention you were beating Billy Caffiero too, did you?
No, I must have left that out.
A minute ago, you said something else. You said you went to Mrs. Santasuso's house to grab a knife. Isn't that true?
Yes. Tommy said that we might need it to hack up Billy's body.
Well, the police asked you what you took from Mrs. Santasuso's house, right?
Yes.
First time they asked you, you didn't mention a knife, did you?
No, I must have forgot.
That's right. You said you must have forgotten that you're saying you picked up the murder weapon. Isn't that true?
Yes, like I just said, I must have forgotten mentioning the knife.
The first time the police asked you what happened to Billy Caffiero, Mr. Patrick, your response was, how the hell should I know, right?
Yes, it's difficult for former members of the mob or current members of the mob to work with police or violate Omerta. So it's difficult, especially, you know, it's very difficult to break that willingly. So yes, I didn't initially volunteer that information.
Is that a yes?
Yes.
Here today, you're telling us you were involved with that whole murder, right?
I was there with Tommy, yeah, throughout the whole events.
Let's talk about why you pointed the finger at Tommy Santasuso. Mr. Patrick, you're here as part of a plea agreement, right?
Yes, I do have a cooperation agreement.
As part of that plea deal, you admitted to participating in a criminal conspiracy to murder Billy Caffiero.
I did.
That carries a maximum sentence of 40 years in prison.
That's the way I understood it, yes.
Mr. Patrick, you're not going to spend a single day in prison for that crime.
No.
You also admitted to being an accomplice to Billy Caffiero's murder, right?
I did.
That carries a maximum sentence of life in prison.
Yes, it does.
Mr. Patrick, you're not going to spend the rest of your life in prison, are you?
I hope not, no.
You're not going to spend a single day in prison for that crime either, right?
No, I will not.
Mr. Patrick, you're not going to spend a single day in prison for the part you admit you played in killing another man, are you?
Well, no, I will not. The way I understood it was I just have to tell the truth and that no charges will be brought against me for this murder.
Is that a yes?
Can you repeat the question? I believe it was a no, but I just want to clarify your question. Sorry.
You won't spend a single day in prison for the part you admit you played in the killing of another man, right?
No.
You only got that plea agreement in exchange for pointing the finger at Thomas Santasuso, right?
Well, the way I understood it was that I just need to tell the truth about what happened, and it happened to be that Thomas Santasuso is the person that I have to tell the truth about. So pointing the finger, I don't think is how I would state that.
That's a yes to my question. You only get that plea agreement in exchange for testifying against Thomas Santasuso, right?
That's a different question. Yeah, yes, I would agree to that.
Let's talk about something else you're getting in that plea deal. And Mr. Patrick, your crime family forbids you from selling drugs. Isn't that true?
Yes.
In fact, your mob boss, Paul Vaca, specifically told you he didn't want you selling drugs anymore, right?
He did make that clear, yes.
He warned you he'd kill you if he caught you dealing again.
He did, but the first time he caught me, he didn't kill me. So, you know, hopefully it was something me and Paulie could work out.
That's a yes. He said he'd kill you if he caught you dealing again, right?
He did say that. I was just clarifying on what I actually thought he meant.
Sergeant Roush arrested you with 700 grams of heroin in your car. Isn't that true?
Yes.
You knew the mob might kill you for breaking their rules?
Yes, as far as the drugs, but I was more concerned about, you know, violating Omerta. But, you know, again, since me and Paulie had had that discussion, I was a little worried about that as well.
You knew the mob could kill you if you didn't go to prison, right, sir?
Yes, they can reach you pretty much anywhere.
That's right. You knew the mob could kill you even if you did go to prison, right?
Yes.
You might kill your family, Mr. Patrick.
Exactly. And that's why this cooperation agreement was so important to me, that my family is protected.
Your daughters?
Yes.
Sergeant Roush told you that cooperating with the government was your only way out. Isn't that true?
They did, but I was still very hesitant at first to, you know, work with them or provide, you know, the information that I had, because again, it's, you know, violating Omerta is the highest crime you can have in the mafia. So I was still hesitant at first to work with them. Yes.
That's a yes.
Yes.
You knew you wouldn't be alive long unless you did something. Isn't that true?
Yes, I knew, you know, it was in danger, yes.
That's when Sergeant Roush offered you witness protection.
She did, after I, you know, she knew I had the information about what happened on June 11th.
And suddenly, Mr. Patrick, you decided you wanted to talk to the cops, right?
Well, when I was picked up originally, I mean, I knew the situation, but you know, once I'd had time to think it over, I felt that it was best for the safety of my family and myself to, you know, work with the police and provide the information that I have.
Mr. Patrick, you only got that witness protection in exchange for testifying against Tommy Santasusa, right?
Well, they were looking to find out and solve, you know, the murder that happened on June 11th. And since it was Tommy, I did have to point the finger at Tommy, yes.
Is that a yes? You only got that witness protection in exchange for, like you said, pointing the finger at Tommy Santasusa.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Patrick. No further questions, Your Honor.
Any redirect examination?
Yes, Your Honor. Mr. Patrick, has Paulie Vaca caught you selling drugs before?
Yes.
Did he try to kill you?
No, he did not.
So we've heard a lot about this cooperation agreement. Who exactly does it protect you from?
It protects me and my family from La Cosa Nostra.
Why?
If you touch a made man or break Omerta like I have, then you'll need protecting from La Cosa Nostra.
And who in this courtroom is a part of La Cosa Nostra?
Thomas Santasusso is.
No further questions. May this witness be excused, Your Honor?
I'm with me.
New recross, Your Honor.
All right. The witness is excused. Commonwealth, call your next witness.
Hey, Your Honor, at this time, the Commonwealth calls Sergeant Lynn Roush.
All right. Sergeant Roush, you are pre-sworn. You may begin your examination whenever you're ready.
Good afternoon. When you're ready, please introduce yourself to the jury and spell your last name for the record.
Good afternoon. I'm Sergeant Lynn Roush, R-A-U-S-C-H.
Where do you work?
I work in the Siena Police Department in the Homicide Investigations Unit.
What does that unit do?
It's a special unit. Essentially, we investigate homicides from, you know, start to finish. That includes things like preserving a crime scene, collecting evidence, analyzing that evidence, and testifying in court.
How long have you been with the Siena Police Department in total?
12 years.
What about just in homicide?
8 years in homicide.
What did you do before you worked for the department?
School. I graduated from Pace University with a degree in criminology, and then right after that, I went to the Siena Police Academy.
Other than that academy, do you have training in homicide investigation?
Yes, ma'am. I've also taken classes at the National Forensic Science Technology Center and the National Institute for Justice, essential classes. So like DNA analysis, fingerprint analysis, gunshot residue analysis, and ABCs of interviews.
About how many homicides would you say you've investigated so far?
30 homicides so far.
Have you testified regarding any?
Yes, ma'am, for 9 of them. And given the nature of my work, it's been for the prosecution each time.
Sergeant, I want to talk now about why you're here today. How do you know of William Cafiero?
I investigated a homicide in which he was the victim of.
Did you know of Mr. Cafiero before he was killed?
Yes, ma'am, I did.
How so?
He had been in prior investigations with the Montanari crime family before.
What state did this occur in?
In Pennsylvania.
What city?
In Siena.
And in what county?
In Klein County.
Now I want to turn your attention over to the actual investigation that took place. How did you become involved?
It was assigned to me after his wife called 911 and reported him missing.
So how did you start your investigation?
So we started at the Bamboo Lounge because it's a known crime family hangout area, but also it was because it was the last place that William Cafiero was seen.
And just to be clear, who exactly is we?
Another officer and myself, Officer Wentz.
What did you and Officer Wentz do at the Bamboo Lounge?
So we got there and interviewed the bartender, learned about a fight that happened that evening. That fight involved the defendant, his friend Nick Patrick, and the victim, William Cafiero.
Where did your investigation take you from there?
We went to Nick Patrick's house next. From past surveillance, we knew that he owed William Cafiero money. And at that point, he was one of our suspects, him and another guy.
What money did he owe?
Well, William Cafiero had been in jail for a year. And typically, when captains are in jail, they appoint people to run illegal activities for them. We knew from past surveillance that Nick Patrick was running an illegal card game, and that that when he got out of jail, that William Cafiero would come to collect.
What else did you know from prior surveillance?
We also knew that the defendant owed Mr. Cafiero a sum of money.
Objection, Your Honor. Lack of foundation.
Response?
Your Honor, may we sidebar?
Sure.
The witness has previously testified that she has investigated 30 homicides, and including cases involving La Cosa Nostra and the members within.
Yep. Have you heard, Your Honor?
Sure, go ahead.
That's just not sufficient foundation for her to testify specifically that Thomas Santos Suso owed William Cafiero money. She hasn't said any facts or data that can give her the basis for that conclusion or what method she used to reach that conclusion.
Response.
Your Honor, the witness did testify that the method by which she's aware of this information is her prior surveillance.
Okay, I'm going to sustain the objection, but it can be cured by just showing how this witness would know that there is money owed by these specific individuals.
Move to strike pending that foundation, Your Honor.
All right, sustained. The jury will disregard.
Sergeant, had you surveilled the defendant before?
Yes, ma'am.
And what did you found out from that surveillance?
So, as I mentioned, when people like William Cafiero are in jail, they appoint, you know, soldiers or associates to take over their illegal activities for them. And we knew from past surveillance that multiple soldiers and associates were doing such, those soldiers and associates being Nick Patrick and Thompson Suit.
So tell us what happened at Mr. Patrick's house.
So we approached him. He was sitting outside of his house in his vehicle. He was reluctant to speak with us. And at that point, we saw a bag of white substance on the floor of his car. We arrested him as a result and brought him in for an interview to the station.
What happened during that interview?
We interviewed him and learned that he was involved in the defendant's killing of William Cafiero.
Mr. Patrick gave you that information?
Yes, ma'am. So as I mentioned, he was reluctant to speak with us and we got the Commonwealth involved and they were able to offer him a cooperation agreement, essentially in exchange for his cooperation. And so he did.
What else did you learn during that interview?
He gave us a location of the body.
Where was that body?
We found it buried in a field with a chef's knife.
Do you know where that knife came from?
Yes, ma'am. So later on in that investigation, we got search warrants from for the defendant's home and the defendant's mother's home. And at that point, when we searched the defendant's mother's home, she had a set of knives. That set of knives was a similar design and style as the chef's knife we found. And more importantly, that set of knives was missing a chef's knife.
Referring opposing counsel to what's been previously marked as Exhibit 23C for identification purposes. Sergeant, in the packet that you've been provided for today's trial, please turn to Exhibit 23C and let me know when you've gotten there.
I'm there.
Your Honor, have you had a chance to turn to Exhibit 23C as well?
I'm there.
Sergeant, do you recognize this?
Yes, ma'am.
How do you recognize this?
I've seen this before.
What is this?
This is a photo of the knife set that I mentioned earlier.
Is this a fair and accurate depiction of what that case looked like when you found it?
Yes, ma'am.
No alterations to this photo?
Yes, ma'am.
No deletions?
That's correct.
Your Honor, at this time, prosecution moves into evidence what's been previously marked as Exhibit 23C for identification purposes as prosecution's Exhibit 23C.
Any objections?
Just a point of order, Your Honor. There are actually three parts to this exhibit, 23A, B, and C. They all show the exact same knife block and knife set. Just so that the members of the jury have the entire thing in front of them, we'd ask that they enter all of Exhibit 23 in at once.
Is that okay? You use all three or you just want 23C?
No objection to the whole exhibit being admitted, Your Honor.
All right, we'll consider all three photos then are admitted.
Permission to publish a demonstrative of exhibits 12A and 23C together?
You may.
Sergeant, what are the designs on these items?
So essentially, they are black and silver knives. The handle is black and the blade is silver. They have three rivets on the handle. The handles have a certain unique curve on them. They're essentially identical.
Objection, Your Honor. Lack of foundation that that curve is unique.
Response?
Your Honor, Sergeant is just testifying as to her perception of the design of these knives.
May we be heard at sidebar, Your Honor?
You may.
Your Honor, there's been no foundation that this witness ever looked at additional knives, ever compared this knife to other sets. She doesn't have the foundation to say that this is a unique curve, and that could prejudice the jury into thinking that this knife set is actually unique. We'd ask that that foundation be laid before she says this, or that that be stricken from the record.
I'm going to overrule that objection. You can certainly go into that on cross-examination if you'd like.
Sergeant, if you don't mind, could you just restate the significance, please, of the designs on these items?
Yes, ma'am. So they are essentially a set of, you know, black and silver knives. That handle is black and the blade is silver. Each handle has three rivets on it and a unique curve. They are essentially identical.
Was anything on this knife at the time you found it?
Yes, ma'am. So when we first found this knife buried with the victim's body, we found red substance on it that we presumed to be blood. We later sent that in for testing, and it was confirmed to be blood. And if you zoom in, there are stains remaining on that knife. I'm going to go ahead and circle those stains in a red circle here.
What was the significance of that to your investigation?
Well, given the fact that it was indeed the victim's blood and that this was essentially the knife that we found buried with the body and that this knife matched the defendant's mother's set and it came from that home.
Did you find anything else throughout the course of your investigation?
Yes, ma'am. So we also learned that Nick Patrick's vehicle was involved as well as a shovel that was later found in that car and we sent those in for testing as well.
Permission to publish Exhibit 29, which has been pre-admitted by this court's ruling.
Okay.
What does this report conclude about that car?
So if you zoom in to that conclusions portion, you will see a few things. So if you'll allow me one moment here. So you'll see here that we that there was a fingerprint found. That fingerprint belonged to Thomas Santasuso. You'll also see that there were traces of blood and hair that were found in that car. That blood was a DNA match for William Cafiero, and that hair was also a DNA match for William Cafiero.
What about the shovel you mentioned?
It was inconclusive as far as fingerprints.
And what about the knife?
Well, as I mentioned, the knife was did indeed have blood on it, and that blood was a DNA match to William Cafiero. But as far as fingerprints, it was inconclusive as far as fingerprints.
What did that blood match mean for your investigation?
Well, this plus the knife case, it meant that this was a knife that was used to kill William Cafiero.
Did you look at any other helpful materials throughout your investigation?
Yes, ma'am. We also looked at the defendant's phone records.
Would those records aid in your testimony?
Yes, ma'am.
Referring opposing counsel to what's been previously marked as Exhibit 16 for identification purposes. Sergeant, in that same packet, please turn to Exhibit Number 16 and let me know when you've gotten there.
I'm there.
Your Honor, have you had the chance as well?
I have it, yes.
Do you recognize this?
Yes, ma'am, I do.
How do you recognize this?
I've seen this before.
What is this?
This is a copy of the defendant's phone records.
Is this a fair and accurate depiction of the defendant's phone activity?
Yes, ma'am.
Your Honor, at this time, prosecution moves into evidence what's been previously marked as Exhibit 16 for identification purposes as prosecution's Exhibit 16.
Any objection?
No objection, Your Honor. We have an affidavit that is, in fact, a valid business record.
All right. So this will be entered as Exhibit 16.
Permission to publish, Your Honor?
You may.
What do these records tell us?
So there are a few portions to these records. So in that first portion, that set of call logs, you'll see that the sixth call was a call made from the defendant to Nick Patrick on the night of the murder of William Cafiero, which confirmed Nick Patrick's story of how the victim was taken into the alley. And then if you scroll just a little bit further down, you'll see text messages wherein the defendant calls the victim a bastard, showing animosity towards him, but also confirming that the defendant would indeed be stopping by his mother's house that evening, which once again matched Nick Patrick's story. And then if you scroll to that last portion, that yes portion, you'll see a few things. You'll see first, when the defendant came back that evening for 11 minutes to that surrounding area of that bamboo lounge. And then shortly after he made that call, you'll see that around 9:25, his phone lost signal, and that signal was never returned.
And Sergeant, if that signal hadn't been lost, would we have the coordinates for that time period as well?
Yes, ma'am.
Did that have an impact on your investigation?
It did. Yes, ma'am.
How so?
Well, based on my experience and the investigation, it looks like it was disabled.
Was that all that you looked at throughout the course of your investigation?
So when we found the body of William Cafiero, we sent that in for an autopsy, and the autopsy report was helpful as well.
Permission to publish Exhibit 15, which has been admitted by this court's prior ruling?
You may.
Sergeant, what are we looking at here?
This is the autopsy of William Cafiero.
What does it tell us about his death?
So if you zoom into that first portion where it says cause of death, you'll see a few things. You'll see first that the defendant did indeed die of multiple stab wounds to the right ventricle of his heart, as well as that exactly that evening of June 11th, 2019, sometime between 11 a.m. and 1 a.m. But also, and again, importantly, that external examination shows us a few things. It shows us that first, there was indeed obvious bruising and lacerations to his right cheek and head. He had injuries on his neck, chest, abdomen. His hands, fingers, feet, and toes were severely bruised, which matched Nick Patrick's story, as to how that call happened. He was taken into the alley where he was subjected to the defendant's essential beating of him.
How did you conclude your investigation?
We then got an arrest warrant and arrested the defendant.
What was the result of your investigation?
Well, after the investigation, the witnesses that we interviewed, the evidence we found, the corroborating DNA on that evidence, it was that the defendant killed William Cafiero on June 11, 2019.
Thank you, Sergeant. No further questions.
Cross-examination.
Your Honor, before I proceed with cross-examination, we'd actually like to read onto the record portions of Catherine Santasuso's testimony pursuant to stipulation she is an unavailable witness under 804.
I'm not inclined to have you do this on cross-examination. If you want to do this in your case in chief, since that's more akin to calling a witness.
Of course, Your Honor. May I be heard as to that?
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, Your Honor, there's a stipulation that this witness is familiar with all exhibits in this case. That includes the deposition of Catherine Santasuso. She just told us that the story that Nick Patrick told was corroborated by the evidence about Thomas Santasuso visiting his mother on June 11th. The deposition of Catherine Santasuso goes to directly contradict that, and I would like to question her regarding Nick Patrick's story.
You can question her regarding things that she looked at during her investigation, but I'm not gonna entertain reading a portion of somebody else's deposition at this time.
Of course, Your Honor. May I proceed?
You may.
Good afternoon, Sergeant.
Good afternoon.
I want to start with your interrogation of Nick Patrick. That was on June 14th of 2019?
That sounds about right. Yes, sir.
Nick Patrick told you about going to Thomas Santasuso's mother's house that night, correct?
He did. Yes, sir.
He told you that he and Thomas Santasuso drove there in a black car, right?
He did, yes, sir.
In Nick Patrick's black car, right?
He did, yes, sir.
That when they drove there, Thomas Santasuso was covered in blood, correct?
According to Nick Patrick, yes, sir.
And according to Nick Patrick, he actually went inside and ate Mrs. Santasuso's food that night, right?
Yes, sir.
Let's talk about how you got Nick Patrick to cooperate. Now, in your entire investigation, there was actually only one witness who told you that Thomas Santasuso killed William Cafiero, right?
Yes, sir. It just so happened to be that one witness was the only other accomplice.
That one witness was Nick Patrick, right?
That's correct. Yes, sir.
Let's talk about when Nick Patrick pointed the finger at Thomas Santasuso. You had just arrested Nick Patrick, right?
That's correct, yes, sir. We did arrest him that day.
You found him with 700 grams of heroin, true?
That's correct. The arrest was for possession with intent.
Well, at first, Nick Patrick, he refused to cooperate with you, right?
That's correct. It's very typical of mafiosos to do based on prior investigations. And as you all heard, they have that code of silence.
Well, you actually asked Nick Patrick what happened to William Cafiero, right?
Just like I said, I did, and he was reluctant to speak with us.
Well, specifically, he said, how the hell should I know, right?
That's what I said, Counselor.
But then you brought up his family, didn't you, Sergeant?
I brought up a lot of things. Again, being in this field and dealing with mafiosos, you tend to try to appease to their ethos to get them to cooperate and break that code of silence.
Let's talk about how you got Nick Patrick to break that code of silence. You told him that if he didn't help you out, he was going to die, right?
That's what I said. Yes, sir. We use a lot of tactics to appeal to their ethos. Yes, sir.
That his wife was going to die, right?
Yes, sir. We use a lot of tactics to get him to cooperate.
You told him his daughters were going to die. Right?
Objection, Your Honor. At this point, this is cumulative.
May I be heard, Your Honor?
Overruled.
He told Nick Patrick that his daughters were going to die if he didn't cooperate, right?
Again, yes, sir, I did. It is one of the other tactics that we used, yes, sir.
And it was only after he had told Nick Patrick this that he pointed the finger at Thomas Santasusa, right?
So at the time, we knew that Thomas Santasusa was a suspect and so was Nick Patrick. We asked him to cooperate and that's when he agreed to cooperate and told us that it was Thomas Santasusa. At that point, I didn't know that he would do so. I didn't know who would he.
Detective, I'm sorry there. I want to make sure we hear one thing. You already knew Thomas Santasusa was a suspect at this point, right?
That's correct. That's what I said. So when we got to the bar and learned about the fight, we knew that that fight involved the victim, Thomas Santasusa, and Patrick, and then another mafia associate. So all of them were suspects at that point.
And Sergeant, at this point, while you were interrogating Nick Patrick, you actually told Nick Patrick that Thomas Santasusa was your suspect, right?
We did, yes, sir. We knew that they were friends, and we said that, yes, sir.
In this interrogation, Nick Patrick wasn't the first person to say the name Thomas Santasusa, right?
That's correct, yes, sir.
You were. Isn't that true?
Yes, sir. That's correct.
Let's talk about if the evidence matches what Nick Patrick claims. Now, Nick Patrick told you that Thomas Santasusa beat the victim unconscious with his bare hands, right?
Yes, sir.
When you arrested Thomas Santasusa, he didn't have any cuts on his hands, right?
No, sir. It was a few days later. I'm not quite sure what bruises or what bruises he may have had or may have not had, but no, he did not have any.
Well, a few days after Thomas Santasusa supposedly beat someone unconscious with his bare hands, you didn't see any bruises on his hands either, right?
Then I don't know. It had been a few days. We weren't sure how severe or not severe any bruises or cuts would be. So, but we didn't see any. No, sir.
According to Nick Patrick, Thomas Santasusa beat the victim till there was blood all over Thomas Santasusa, right?
Yes, sir, as I mentioned before.
When you collected Thomas Santasusa's suit from that night, there was no blood on it though, right?
No, sir, it appeared to have been laundered.
We'll get to whether or not it was clean in a second, Sergeant, but you also collected his tie and there was no blood on that, right?
Again, the clothing appeared to have been laundered.
That includes his white shirt. No blood on that.
Yes, sir.
You just told us that they were cleaned. Sergeant, the forensic lab, they didn't tell you that, did they?
No, sir. They weren't sent to a forensic lab.
So, Sergeant, it's your testimony that you collected the clothes that supposedly had blood all over them and you didn't send them to a forensic lab?
I don't recall, sir.
You don't recall if you sent them to a forensic lab?
No, sir. The clothing appeared to have been laundered. That's what I said.
So let's talk about Nick Patrick's car. If you won't mind turning in your casebook to, I believe it's Exhibit 18 on page 44.
Sure, I'm here.
Now that appears to be a fair and accurate representation of Nick Patrick's car, right?
That's correct, yes, sir.
And if you could flip the page to Exhibit 19.
Sure.
That's a picture of Nick Patrick's trunk of that car, right?
Yes, sir.
That appears to be fair and accurate as well, doesn't it?
It seems so, yes, sir.
Your Honor, defense offers Exhibits 18 and 19 into evidence.
Any objection?
No objection, Your Honor.
All right. Exhibits 18 and 19 are entered in evidence.
May we publish?
You may.
Sergeant, Nick Patrick claimed that Thomas Santasusa put the victim into the trunk of that car, right?
That's correct, yes, sir.
And that then he and Nick Patrick rode inside the car on the night of the murder, right?
That's correct. Yes, sir.
There were no fingerprints from Thomas Santasuso inside that car, correct?
According to the lab report, they're on the door handle, sir.
So no fingerprints inside the car, right?
According to the lab report, they're on the door handle, sir.
That's one thumbprint on the outside of the car, right?
They're on the door handle, sir, according to the lab report.
There was no hair from Thomas Santasuso inside this car, right?
No, sir. We didn't anticipate there would be.
No DNA?
Again, sir, other than the thumbprint on the door handle, no, sir.
Let's talk about the trunk of this car, then. The trunk of this car, Nick Patrick's DNA was found inside of it, right?
That's correct. So, again, it was Nick Patrick's car. It would be normal for his DNA to be in there, but it was found in there. Yes, sir, along with William Caffiero's.
Pardon me, Sergeant. I wasn't asking you what you were expecting, just what was found inside. Nick Patrick's DNA was found inside that trunk, right?
It was. Yes, sir. My apologies. I did say yes.
Not a problem. Thomas or William Caffiero's DNA was also found in that the trunk of that car. True?
As I mentioned, yes, sir. His hair and his blood.
But Thomas Santasuso's DNA was not found in the trunk of that car, right?
No, sir. It was not. Again, according to Nick Patrick, Thomas Santasuso was the one that did the stabbing while Nick Patrick opened the trunk.
Sorry, Sergeant. No. I think I might have lost your answer there. Thomas Santasuso's DNA was not in the trunk of this car. Yes or no?
Oh, my apologies. I thought you were asking if it was on the trunk of the car. No, sir. It was not in the trunk of the car.
Sergeant, let's talk about the knife then. Your Honor, permission to republish exhibits that were entered on direct examination?
You may. Anything that's in evidence, you don't have to ask permission to republish. Just do it.
Yes, Your Honor. Ms. Stebbins, if we could go on to the knife. Sergeant, let's talk about whether this knife can be linked to Mr. Santasuso. You believe this knife was the murder weapon, right?
It was found with the body. Yes, sir.
There were no fingerprints from Mr. Santasuso on this knife, right?
The forensic report came back inconclusive as far as fingerprints, so that doesn't mean there weren't fingerprints. It just means that there wasn't enough to match a fingerprint.
So you didn't find any fingerprints that could be linked to Mr. Santasuso on this knife, correct?
It was inconclusive, sir.
No DNA from Mr. Santasuso on this knife, right?
Other than the victim's DNA and that being blood on the knife, no, sir.
I'm sorry, Sergeant. That was a no to Mr. Santasuso's DNA being on this knife.
That's correct, sir.
Now, you believe that this murder weapon came from this knife block, right?
We do, yes, sir.
Sergeant, you see there's a logo on that knife block, don't you?
I do, yes, sir.
Ms. Evans, can we blow that up? Sergeant, you never found out what company that logo belongs to, right?
I don't recall that being a part of my investigation.
So you don't know if the same company that made this knife block made the knife you found, right?
I don't recall that being a part of my investigation, but also there was no logo on the knife. So I'm not quite sure what you mean there.
Well, Sergeant, you never actually measured the width of that knife to see if it would fit inside of that knife slot, right?
I don't recall.
You don't recall measuring it?
I do not recall, sir.
Then you don't recall measuring the length of that knife to see if it would fit inside the knife slot?
No, sir, I don't.
Sergeant, you never actually put that knife into that knife block to see if it fit at all, right?
I don't recall, sir.
No further questions.
Can you redirect examination?
Yes, Your Honor.
You may proceed.
Sergeant, what type of knife was found with the body?
Chef's knife.
What type of knife was missing from the defendant's mother's case?
Chef's knife.
Can you tell us what the significance was of the knife case and the knife having the same type being the knife end missing?
Of course, yes, ma'am. So finding that chef's knife with the body means that it's essentially the knife that was used to kill the victim, and finding a missing chef's knife that is essentially identical to the set of knives at the defendant's mother's home essentially means for the investigation that that chef's knife came from that knife box.
Did that link the defendant to this crime?
Yes, ma'am, absolutely.
No further questions.
Okay. May this witness be excused?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, Your Honor, no recross.
Right. All right, this witness is excused. Commonwealth, call your next witness.
Your Honor, at this time, the Commonwealth rests.
Okay.
Your Honor, in that case, the defense does have a motion.
All right, what is your motion, defense?
We move for judgment of acquittal under Rule 29 of the Federal Rules of Criminal Procedure. Even under the light most favorable to the non-moving party, no reasonable jury could find that the prosecution has met their case beyond a reasonable doubt. Specifically, Your Honor, there is contradictory forensic evidence to the state, to the Commonwealth's only eyewitness. There has been no explanation for that contradiction and no attempt to discredit that forensic evidence. Therefore, no reasonable jury could find that they have met their burden.
Response.
Your Honor, Nick Patrick told us the defendant went back to the bar at 9:15 that night. Sergeant Rouse showed us that the defendant was outside the bar when he made that call. Nick Patrick told us where the knife came from, and Sergeant Rouse showed us that the defendant's mother was missing the exact same type of knife that was from, that was mentioned from Nick Patrick. And lastly, Nick Patrick told us the defendant used that knife to kill the victim, and Sergeant Rouse showed us that the victim was killed from stab wounds and the right side of his chest. And for that reason, we would request this motion be denied.
All right. I think there is sufficient evidence to send this to the jury, so I'm going to overrule the motion at this time. Would you like to have a brief recess before we begin the defense case in chief, or are you ready? Would you like to just plug along?
Your Honor, could we have 5 minutes?
Let's make it 10. I have 35 after the hour. Let's come back at 45 after the hour. I got to find a charger for my computer.
Thank you, Your Honor. See you then.
We'll be back. Court is adjourned until 45 after the hour. if the bailiff can check and make sure that all our jurors are back.
Can we just have our jurors indicate in the chat or unmuting themselves that they're here?
I'm here.
I'm here.
Okay, so we have Varghese. I saw Paul, Fred, Jordan, Lorraine, and Ashley. Ashley's here, so I'm just looking, making sure Fred, Jordan, and Lorraine are here.
I'm here, Phil.
Okay, see Fred. So just waiting for Lorraine and Jordan.
We're waiting. No.
Jordan's that you?
Yep, Jordan's here.
Okay, just waiting on Lorraine then.
I'm here. Sorry.
Okay, we're all good. Ready to go, Joe.
All right, super. Please take note that the time check was given in the chat. So if you haven't noticed that, make sure both sides have seen how much time they have remaining for the defense case in chief. With that being said, defense, call your first witness.
Your Honor, before we do, may we read onto the record at this point Catherine Santasuso's prior deposition testimony?
Any objection to that?
We can give specific line numbers if that would be helpful. We intend to read lines 41 through 43 up to the word driveway, and then lines 57 through 62.
No objection, Your Honor.
All right, you may proceed.
I will be reading the questions. My co-counsel, Ms. Stebbins, will be reading the answers. Question. Do you remember seeing Tommy on the night of June 11th, 2019?
Yes. I heard a car pull into my driveway. So I got up and looked out my window and I saw Tommy's white Cadillac.
Just click on the...
And on to lines 57. When Tommy arrived, was he alone?
Yes.
Was there blood on his clothes?
No.
How about his face and hands?
No.
Thank you. Your Honor, that concludes our that portion of reading onto the record, and Ms. Stebbins will call our first witness.
All right.
Your Honor, the defense calls Lee Symbol.
Lee Symbol, you are pre-sworn. Stebbins is going to ask you some questions. You may begin whenever you're ready.
Yes, Your Honor. Good afternoon, Mr. Symbol. Can you see and hear me all right?
Yeah, thank you. Can you hear me all right?
I can. Could you please introduce yourself to the jury?
Hi, I'm Lee Symbol.
Where are you from, Mr. Symbol?
Originally, I'm from California, but I moved out here for college.
Where'd you go to school?
I went to Westchester for undergrad, and then I just graduated from Drexel Law back in May.
Are you working?
Yeah, right now I'm still attending bar part-time at the Bamboo Lounge while I'm waiting on my bar results to come back.
You said you work at the Bamboo Lounge, but what's the address of the Bamboo Lounge?
It's at 3929 Market here in Siena.
I want to turn your attention to this case. Mr. Symbol, could you turn to what's been marked as Exhibit 2? It's on page 12 of your electronic notebook, and let me know when you're there.
Yeah, I'm there.
Do you recognize this?
Yeah.
What is it?
It's a picture of Billy and Tommy.
Does it appear fair and accurate?
Yeah.
Your Honor, defense offers Exhibit 2 into evidence.
The objection?
Yes, Your Honor. For lack of foundation, I believe there was a question missed.
I'm going to overrule the objection and enter the photo.
May we publish, Your Honor?
You may.
Mr. Symbol, you said this was a photo of Tommy Santasuso and Billy Caffiero. Who's the person on the left?
That's Billy on the left, Billy Caffiero.
Who's the person on the right?
That's Tommy.
How did you know Tommy Santasusa?
He was a regular at the bar at the Bamboo Lounge. So I'd see him come in there pretty often.
Thank you, Mr. Wax. We can take that down. How well did you know him, sir?
I'd say I know him pretty well. He was a regular there for years while I was working at the lounge. I'd say we were friends. I mean, he helped me out a little bit here and there. We got to know each other throughout the years.
Do you know his family?
Yeah. Yeah. I've met his wife, Kim, and he has a daughter, Santina.
I want to move on now to June 11th, the night of Billy Caffiero's murder. What were you doing that night?
I was tending bar. I worked until close.
Were either Tommy Santasusa or Billy Caffiero there that night?
Yeah, they were both there.
What time did Billy Caffiero get there?
Billy got there around 6 or 7.
Well, that night, did you witness a confrontation between Tommy Santasusa and Billy Caffiero?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they got into an argument that night.
What happened?
Billy was making fun of Tom. You see, Tommy used to be a chauffeur, and Billy was kind of chirping him about, you know, how he used to be a chauffeur, saying stuff like, you know, why don't you pull my car around, kid? And then they started yelling at each other. You know, I'm going to kill you. You know, what are you getting fresh for? That kind of thing. Tommy threw his drink at one point.
You said Tommy Santasusa threw a glass. Did he hit anyone with that glass?
No.
Did he pull out a weapon?
No, nothing like that.
Did he touch Billy Caffiero at all?
No. There was a lot, like I said, there was a lot of yelling, but nobody got physical.
Well, who left first, Billy Caffiero or Tommy Santasusa?
Tommy. Tommy left, and pretty much right after they got into that argument.
When Tommy Santasusa left the bar, was Billy Caffiero still alive?
Yeah, he was still at the bar.
Who was the last person who you saw with Billy Caffiero that night?
The last person I saw him with was Nick Patrick. They left together later that night.
Well, let's talk about Nick Patrick. How did you know him?
He's another regular.
Did you see him ever speaking with someone named Paul Vaca?
Paulie? Yeah. I'd seen him, you know, talking to, or I guess getting talked to by Paulie at one point.
When?
It would have been February, a couple of years ago.
What do they talk about?
They were talking about how Nick was dealing drugs.
What did Mr. Vaca tell him?
I mean, Paulie was yelling at him. You know, he was saying, I don't want you doing any more of that stuff, all right? The drugs. And then he kind of grabbed Nick, you know, around the collar, kind of picked him up, said, you know, stop selling them. I'm warning you. Next time, there won't be no next time. And then he kind of did this with his hand.
Your Honor, for the record, the witness made the sign of a gun with his hand.
So no.
After Paul Vaca warned Nick Patrick not to sell drugs anymore, did you ever see anyone else talk to Nick Patrick about selling drugs?
Yeah.
Objection, hearsay. Question calls for hearsay.
Response.
Your Honor, the question I asked him was who he saw talking to him, not what he said, but if we could be heard outside the presence of the jury.
No, I'll overrule the objection. You proceed.
What did he say?
This was Billy, you know, kind of that night, earlier that night before Billy and Nick left. And Billy was talking to him about some money he owed him. Billy told Nick, you know, you know, you owe me that 200 grand. And if you don't pay, I'm going to tell Paulie that you're still out here dealing drugs.
When you heard Billy Caffiero threaten to tell Paul Vaca that Nick Patrick was still dealing, sir, what day was that?
That was June 11th. That was the night Billy got killed.
Thank you, Mr. Simple. No further questions, Your Honor.
cross-examination?
Yes, Your Honor. Now, Mr. Semble, as you stated, you were friends with Tommy Santasusa.
Yeah.
Well, actually, you consider yourself a close friend of Tommy Santasusa's.
Yeah, we were close. I mean, he came into the bar all the time.
And your close friend got you a job you really wanted.
I wouldn't say he got me a job. I mean, I think I got me a job based on how I did in school. But he made a call to a friend over at the PD's office. You know, he knew I was trying to get an internship there. So, yeah, he made a call for me.
I understand. But after he made that call, you received an offer within 24 hours.
Yeah, he knew they were, you know, he made that call. They were thinking about it. I had gone through the interview process, everything. So, yeah. I mean.
Now, Tommy also gives you free meals at his restaurant, doesn't he?
Yeah. Yeah, it's good authentic Italian food. He does.
And Tommy's lent you a lot of money over the years.
I wouldn't say a lot of money, but he's lent me some money, yeah.
Well, you didn't have that money, and that's why Tommy lent it to you.
Yeah. I mean, I asked for it. I mean, sometimes it was, you know, cover a phone bill, cover a, you know, heating bill, something like that. I always got the money back to him, though.
Except for one time.
Yeah, there was one time he, I mean, it wasn't much, but he didn't have me paying back. And, you know, it was nice. It was a good tip.
Well, he didn't have you pay him back with money, but he said you could repay him with a favor in the future.
No.
He never said you could repay him when you're a lawyer one day?
No. He said, he didn't say I would have to repay him with a favor.
Let me rephrase. He said he may need a favor from a lawyer one day and to consider it an investment.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. He said he might need a favor one day, but I mean, I'm going to be a lawyer, man. I mean, I think, you know, everybody needs a friend that's a lawyer.
Mm-hmm. Now I want to talk to you why we're really here. Let's talk about June 11th, okay?
Okay.
Well, before we do that, just to clarify, you're not in the mafia?
No.
You're not a part of any family?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last part there.
Well, I'm just clarifying again, you're not a part of any crime family?
No.
And as you stated, you're a bartender at the Bamboo Lounge.
Yeah.
And you worked on June 11th, right?
Yeah, I was closing down that night.
And as you mentioned, you saw Tommy Santasusa try to fight William Caffiera.
I don't think I saw him try to fight him. I mean, they were yelling, but.
Well, we can break it down. You saw Tommy throw his glass at William Caffiera.
No. Did somebody tell you he threw the glass at Billy?
You just did on direct examination, Mr. Semble.
No, I did. I wouldn't say that. He didn't throw the glass at Billy.
Oh, he didn't throw the glass in Billy's general direction?
No.
Well, you did hear him scream, "I'm going to kill that guy."
Yeah, he said, I'm going to kill that guy. Yeah.
And he said it again.
Yeah.
And he said it one more time.
Yeah, I think it was, you know, he's like, "I'm going to kill that guy. I'm going to kill this bastard. You know, I'm going to kill you." Yeah.
Well, Mr. Symbol, that was the last time you saw Mr. Caffiera.
I saw him for the rest of the night. Yeah. But that night, yeah, that was last night.
But once he left the Bamboo Lounge, you never saw him again.
No.
That's because he was killed later that night.
That's what I heard. I don't know anything about how it happened, but yeah.
That's right. You don't know anything about how it happened because you never saw it.
I didn't see him get killed. No. I mean, I served him all night. He left around, I mean, maybe 9 o'clock or something like that with Nick, but I mean, I didn't see him ever again. No.
No further questions.
Any redirect examination?
No redirect, Your Honor. May the witness step down?
You may. All right, call your next witness.
The defense calls Mackenzie Ledesma.
Mackenzie Ledesma, you are pre-sworn. You may begin whenever you're ready, Mr. Wax.
Good afternoon. Could you please introduce yourself to the jury?
Good afternoon. Pardon, I'm in a new office with a new setup. My name is Mackenzie Ledesma.
What do you do for a living?
I'm a retired FBI agent, and I'm currently teaching federal investigations at Pace University. I've studied organized crime, most commonly known as the mafia, for the entirety of my career.
Could you tell us how you're involved in today's case?
Sure. I was asked to explain how the mafia's internal rules and structure would have applied to the facts of today's case.
Well, Professor, before we talk about your conclusions, I want the jury to understand your credentials. When you say study the mafia, what do you mean?
I'm referring to their hierarchy, their rules, and their forms of discipline, especially when a member breaks those rules.
And how long have you been studying that?
Over 20 years, first as an investigator with the FBI, then as an author, and now as a professor and consultant.
Let's break that down a bit. Starting with your work at the FBI, what were you doing?
I was working in the Criminal Investigative Division, and after going through thorough training, I was studying the mafia and investigating mafia-related crime.
How many of your investigations over the years involved the mafia?
Easily over 100.
Did any of those investigations involve the Battaglia family here in Siena?
Yes, I've studied and surveilled the Battaglia mafia family here in Siena as part of my jurisdiction.
So then, as an author, have you been published on the topic of the mafia?
Yes, sir. I've been published 3 times. I've written 3 books.
And as a consultant, have you consulted as an expert before?
Yes, over 18 times.
Have you been recognized in court as an expert in the mafia?
Yes, sir. The 3 times I was called to testify, I was recognized by the court as an expert.
Your Honor, we tender Ms. Ledesma as an expert in the mafia as a subsect of organized crime.
Any objection to this witness being allowed to testify as an expert in this field?
Objection, Your Honor.
All right, the witness may so testify.
So, Professor, let's talk about your conclusions. What material did you have access to when making conclusions?
I was provided all of the exhibits, affidavits, interviews, and lab reports of this case. I also considered the current literature and publications regarding the American Mafia, as well as my training and expertise that I obtained during my 10 years at the FBI.
And what principles and methods did you use to conduct that analysis?
I essentially compared the facts of this case and the families involved in today's case to the general structure and rules of the American Mafia, specifically the rules regarding disobedience and discipline.
Well, are those principles reliable?
Yes, these rules I'll be referring to are the rules typically followed by most standard mafia families, including the Battaglia family.
And were you able to form any conclusions to a reasonable degree of certainty within your field?
Yes, sir.
What did you conclude?
I concluded that had the mafia learned or been informed that Mr. Nick Patrick had been arrested with nearly 1 kilogram of heroin, that he would have been marked for death.
All right, Professor, let's start with the basics. When you say mafia, what does that actually mean?
The mafia is a particular branch or subsect of organized crime. It's also known as La Cosa Nostra, which is Italian for our thing.
And how does organized crime differ from regular crime?
Well, when you're talking about organized crime, we're talking about a highly sophisticated structure or group that has its own history, hierarchy, and rules.
Earlier, you mentioned specific families in the mafia. Was Nick Patrick associated with any of those families?
Yes, sir. According to Nick Patrick, he was a member of the Battaglia family.
I want to talk to you about the hierarchy of the Battaglia family. Would a diagram help you to explain that structure?
Yes, sir, it would.
Your Honor, permission to display a demonstrative aid for the members of the jury?
You may.
So, Professor, let's start at the top. Who's at the top of a mafia family?
At the top of a mafia family is known as the boss. And the boss is exactly what it sounds like. They're in charge of their whole particular family's operation, and they receive a cut of any profits of any illegal enterprises that occur below them on the branches.
So who's directly below the boss?
Below the boss is the underboss, and that's exactly what it sounds like. It's the person directly below the boss. Their job strictly adheres when the boss is incarcerated, so they'll take over the organization. They're also involved in some major family decision-making processes.
Are there any sub-officers below the underboss?
Yes, the capo regimes come underneath the underbosses, and they're commonly known as capos, if you've ever heard of them. They're actually appointed from the boss at the top, and they run individual crews.
Who makes up the crews, then?
The crews are made up of soldiers and associates. Soldiers have eligibility to be indoctrinated or initiated into the mafia, whereas associates do not, whether it be because of their gender or their lack of ability to trace their roots back to Italy.
So where was Nick Patrick in this hierarchy in the Battaglia family?
And Nick Patrick was an associate.
And who did Nick Patrick report to? Who was his capo?
Nick Patrick's capo, or the person responsible for setting the rules that Nick Patrick had to abide by, was Paul Vacca.
Thank you, Ms. Evans. We can take that down. Professor, you just told us that Nick Patrick reported to Paul Vacca. From what you reviewed, did Paul Vacca have any rules regarding drugs?
Yes, Paul Vacca strictly banned the sale and or use of drugs.
How do you know?
Nick Patrick discussed it, and an eyewitness overheard Mr. Patrick receiving this order directly from his capo.
Well, is a rule against selling drugs uncommon within the mafia?
No, it's actually quite common. Most mafia families have a ban on the sale and use of drugs.
Why?
It can make them vulnerable to law enforcement. There's a pretty strong history when it comes to the mafia community of mafiosos getting caught selling drugs and then police officers using those members, turning them into informants to help them avoid long prison sentences. So to avoid that vulnerability, most mafia families just ban narcotic sales as a general way of avoiding law enforcement.
Well, in the Battaglia family, what are the consequences for breaking that rule, selling drugs after your capo has told you not to?
Members who sell drugs in direct violation of an order from their capo are marked for death.
Did Nick Patrick follow the rule against selling drugs?
No, sir.
How do you know that?
When Nick Patrick was arrested on June 14th of 2019, he had 700 grams of heroin in his car and was charged with possession with intent to distribute. He also acknowledged that he was still selling drugs after his capo had told him to stop.
You said that members who sell drugs are marked for death. Can they avoid that by going to prison?
Generally, no. There are plenty of mafia members in the prison system, so you can't exactly erase the mafia death sentence simply by being incarcerated.
So when Nick Patrick was arrested with 700 grams of heroin, what did he do?
He cooperated with the government in exchange for witness protection.
Thank you, Professor. No further questions at this time, Your Honor.
Cross-examination?
Yes, Your Honor. Your opinion in this case contradicts Sergeant Rausch?
Pardon, ma'am?
Your opinion in this case, it contradicts that of Sergeant Rausch.
I found that some of Sergeant Rausch's conclusions lacked supporting evidence, so yes.
But you never went to the scene of this crime.
No, ma'am, those weren't the conclusions that I contradicted in my report.
I'm sorry, Ms. Ledesma. My question was, you never went to the scene of this crime. That's correct.
That's correct, ma'am.
All you did was review the materials you were provided.
That's correct.
Then you formed the opinion that it's unlikely two associates murdered a captain.
Absolutely, ma'am.
Because that would be breaking the rules.
It is the highest order in mafia families to not murder above your ranks.
Is that a yes?
Yes, ma'am.
And breaking the rules would get them killed.
Certainly.
It's your opinion the defendant knew of these rules?
Yes, ma'am.
Ms. Ledesma, you wrote a report in this case?
I did.
And in that same report, it's your opinion the defendant wasn't in the mafia?
Specifically at the time of Mr. Caffaro's death, not that he was never affiliated.
That's a yes?
Not exactly.
Yet, at this time, like you said, the defendant was just someone on the outside.
That is what the evidence supported, yes, ma'am.
You also claim to know the ins and outs of the mafia.
That's correct. I've studied them for over 20 years.
But you're not in the mafia.
Certainly not, ma'am.
So you too are someone on the outside.
I mean, I'm technically not in the mafia, but I've studied their organization for over 20 years, so I'd say I have a bit more information than an outsider would.
But you are an outsider.
I would disagree with that, ma'am.
But you're on the outside of the mafia, Ms. Ledesma?
Currently, but I worked on 100 investigations in which I was ingrained into the mafia, so not exactly.
You've spent 26 hours forming your opinion in this case?
That's correct.
You make $750 an hour.
Yes, ma'am.
So just so far, you've made almost $20,000 working on the defendant's case.
That's correct.
And that doesn't include your time today.
That's correct, ma'am.
This is on account of your consulting firm?
Yes, that's correct.
Which makes up 99% of your income.
And takes up 99% of my time. Yes, ma'am.
No further questions.
Redirect.
No redirect, Your Honor. May Professor Ledesma be excused?
She may. Call your next witness.
With that, Your Honor, the defense rests its case.
All right. Any further motions we need to take, or are we ready to move to closing arguments?
No, Your Honor. The defense is ready to proceed to closings.
Same with Commonwealth. Ready for closing?
Yes, Your Honor. We're ready.
All right. Can we get a time check before the close so you have some idea? Looks like we have 16 and 14 minutes, respectively. And remember, there's no extra points for using all your time. So,
yes, Your Honor.
Just keep that in mind. All right, Commonwealth, you may proceed with your closing argument.
Yes, Your Honor. And at this time, we would also like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal.
All right, if 2 minutes are remaining, you may have them for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. One, two, three. 3 seconds is all it took the defendant to make his decision to murder William Caffaro. But it wasn't just 3 seconds. It was three opportunities over the span of 3 hours where the defendant thought about how he could get back at William Caffaro, how he could taste how sweet revenge really is. Now, we heard testimony from four different witnesses today. We saw a ton of evidence relating to the night that William Caffaro was murdered. And unfortunately, in these kinds of trials, the evidence isn't always presented in a way where we can hear it and see it and immediately understand how it relates to the law, which is why Ms. Sonnenblum and I came here today with the burden of showing you how the evidence that was presented does in fact relate to the law. So that at the end of this trial, when the Honorable Judge Lester hands you this verdict form, you're confident that the defendant is guilty of first degree murder, and you're left with no hesitation to check off that he is. Now, here in Pennsylvania, first degree murder just has 3 elements, and each of those elements must be proved beyond a reasonable doubt. So, let's break down these elements. Let's weigh the facts against the law. Number one, William Caffaro is dead. Members of the jury, we know he died on June 11th when he was stabbed numerous times in the heart. See, the autopsy tells us this part of the story, but not the whole story. See, the autopsy doesn't tell us who gashed the knife through Caffaro's chest. But we know who it was because we heard the rest of the story from Nick Patrick. And we saw all the physical evidence Sergeant Roush gathered throughout her investigation. And although William Cafiero is not alive to tell us his side of the story today, he speaks through that evidence. And all that evidence tells us, our second element, that the defendant killed William Cafiero. Members of the jury, the defendant was the only one with a real motive that night. The defendant was the one searching for sweet, sweet revenge. Because as Nick Patrick and Lee Symbol both told us, this all started with a fight in the bamboo lounge. A fight that ended with the defendant screaming that he was going to kill William Cafiero. Let me rephrase. He said, I'm going to kill that bastard. I'm going to kill you, you big, tough guy. Which is exactly why the defendant went back to the bar and called Nick Patrick, not asking him, but telling him, members of the jury, telling him to bring William Cafiero to the alley. And we know that happened because Sergeant Rouse showed us the defendant's phone records. She showed us that he made that call and he was outside the bamboo lounge when he made that call. And what happens as soon as William Cafiero steps into the alley? The defendant jumps him, punching, kicking, smashing his head into the concrete, slamming his skull into the pavement. Which is why William Cafiero's body was found showing signs of a concussion, internal bleeding, and bruising all over. Then the defendant coincidentally loses GPS tracking on his phone. But we know what happened next. We know that Nick Patrick drove the defendant to his mom's house to get a knife and a shovel. Because Nick Patrick told us, and Sergeant Roush found a fresh fingerprint belonging to the defendant on Nick Patrick's door handle. And Sergeant Roush showed us that the knife she found buried with William Cafiero's body just so happened to be the same exact type of knife that was missing from the defendant's mother's house. But the defendant wants us to believe that's just a coincidence too. Well, we know it was no coincidence. And we know why the defendant grabbed the knife in the shovel. The defendant used the knife to stab William Cafiero 5 times. And he used the shovel to bury Cafiero's body in the abandoned field behind the Primrose Diner, just like Nick Patrick told us, and just like Sergeant Roush showed us. But again, coincidentally, the knife and the shovel had no fingerprints on them. Not even the defendant's mother's. So, ask yourself, is it really just one big coincidence that the defendant went back to the bamboo lounge, called Nick Patrick, loses GPS tracking on his phone, happens to leave a fresh fingerprint on Nick Patrick's car? Oh, and then his mom happens to lose the same exact type of knife that was found with William Cafiero's body. And that knife happens to be wiped clean of any fingerprints. No, members of the jury, it's not just one big coincidence. Because once is a coincidence. But three times is a pattern. It's a plan. It's premeditation, which brings us to the third and final element. Let's talk about how we know the defendant willfully and deliberately killed William Cafiero with some sort of premeditation. See, the defendant chose to go back to the bamboo. He chose to grab a knife and a shovel. And he chose exactly when and where William Cafiero would take his last breath. The defendant went out of his way to grab the knife and the shovel. Now, there's no other reason to go grab a knife and a shovel except for the fact that the defendant intended to use them to kill and bury William Cafiero. And that's exactly what he did. He towered over William Cafiero with the knife and listened to Cafiero beg and plead for his life, saying, Tommy, please, Tommy, I've known you my whole life. please. But at that point, the defendant's decision is already made. So he looks at the knife and he looks at Capiro laying helplessly in the trunk, covered in his own blood, beaten to a pulp. And he thrusts the knife through Capiro's ribcage, breaking his ribs, slicing open his heart. Does it stop there? No. Again, he thrusts the knife through Capiro's ribs, breaking anything that stood in the way between his blade and Capiro's heart. And he does it again and again and again, members of the jury, five times. So yeah, we know the defendant intended to kill William Capiro. But when did he make that decision? When did the premeditation occur? See, premeditation, as defined by law, is when someone decides to kill after a moment of reflection. And the decision could be formed over days, hours, or even just 1, 2, 3 seconds. So let's think. Did the defendant make his decision when he decided to go back to the bamboo lounge? Or when he decided to go grab a knife and a shovel from his mom's house? Or was it when he stood over the trunk of the car, heard William Capiro pleading for his life, saying anything he could to save his life? And the defendant looked at his mother's chef knife, looked at Nick Patrick, and counted 1, 2, 3. All members of the jury, the truth is, any one of these moments satisfies premeditation. Because remember, the decision could have been made in even just 3 seconds. So, despite all this evidence proving the defendant's guilt, the defense still brought us 2 witnesses to try and prove otherwise today. 2 witnesses that are practically on the defendant's payroll. And 2 witnesses that never actually saw the murder happen. So what did those witnesses tell us about the murder that we didn't already hear from Nick Patrick and Sergeant Roush? Nothing, members of the jury, which makes sense considering the fact that Nick Patrick was not our only eyewitness, not prosecution's only eyewitness, the only eyewitness in this whole case. And Sergeant Roush was the only person that actually went out and gathered any evidence, actually went out and interviewed suspects. But again, who did the defense bring us? They brought us a bartender, and that's fine. But the murder didn't happen in the bar, members of the jury. So why is he here testifying today? It's because he's in debt to the defendant for all the free meals, for getting him a job, and for all the money the defendant has continuously given him. And how did the defendant ask to be repaid for all that? Because he didn't ask for money. No, he asked to be repaid with a favor in the future, members of the jury. Well, today is the day that favor was due. Because what a better way to repay the defendant than to come in here and testify on his behalf, than to try to help Mac Ledesma build a defense for the defendant, which we know Mac Ledesma was not able to do. Because we heard all about Omerta, which is Lacosa Nostra's code of silence, meaning what happens in Lacosa Nostra stays in Lacosa Nostra. And that's a code of silence they take very, very seriously. I mean, so seriously that Nick Patrick and his whole family have to be in witness protection because they're in danger because he came and testified and told us the story today. And Ledesma told us herself that she is not in Lacosa Nostra. She's considered an outsider. Yet, despite this code of silence, Ledesma claims to know all the details about what goes on inside Lacosa Nostra. And she told us all these theories about how La Cosa Nostra was involved in William Capiro's murder. But members of the jury, she wasn't there. She never gathered any evidence. And most importantly, she is not in La Cosa Nostra. So all these theories that Mac Ledesma has, they're nothing more than conspiracy theories. All Ledesma used was Sergeant Rausch's evidence to come to her opinion today. Yet, as we heard, her opinion somehow contradicted Sergeant Rausch's. Well, maybe that's because Mac Ledesma had her opinion before she even opened up any evidence. See, she had her opinion as soon as the defendant agreed to pay her, because that's how Mac Ledesma makes a living. She's being paid $20,000 today to come and testify on the defendant's behalf. That, members of the jury, that is what we call bias. So, now that you've seen all the evidence and you've heard all the testimony today, we're confident that you'll find there's only one verdict that is supported by all the facts and the law. And that is finding the defendant guilty of first-degree murder when he used his mother's knife to take William Capiro's life. Because remember, members of the jury, all it took was a simple 1, 2, 3 to make that fatal decision. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Raffel. Defense, you have to make a closing argument now?
Yes, Your Honor. May we proceed?
You may.
They're going to kill you. They're going to kill your wife. They're going to kill your daughters. Nick Patrick is trapped. He's just been arrested. He's staring at the white walls of a police interrogation room. There's a police sergeant across from him accusing him of murder. But that's the least of his problems. You see, Nick Patrick, he's in the mafia. His boss has told him if he doesn't stop dealing drugs, they're going to kill him. Members of the jury, he just got caught with 700 grams of heroin. But his luck's about to change. The police, they want to make a deal. They've got a missing mafia member, another suspect, and all they need now is Nick Patrick to point the finger. Point the finger at Thomas Santasusa, and Nick Patrick gets witness protection for his family. Point the finger at Thomas Santasusa, and Nick Patrick gets to live. It was his only way out. When the Commonwealth took Nick Patrick at his word, they also took on a burden. You see, today they had to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that Thomas Santasusa intentionally killed William Cafiero. That's a burden that they failed to meet for three reasons. There was only one eyewitness. You can't trust that witness. And their own forensic evidence contradicts that witness. So let's start with that first point. That their case comes down to not three, but one. One eyewitness. Now, everyone agrees that Thomas Santasusa and William Cafiero got into an argument. But Mr. Santasusa isn't on trial for arguing or threatening or throwing a glass across the room. He's on trial for murder. Members of the jury, the prosecution, they told you, well, we have GPS data that shows you this happened, not just witnesses. We have GPS data that shows you that Thomas Santasusa went back to that bar after. Let's take a look at that evidence that Sergeant Rausch showed you. Now, here's the GPS data that Sergeant Rausch recovered. And you'll see an address there, 3400 Walnut Street. Well, that's not the Bamboo Lounge. That's a cell tower, members of the jury. I haven't told you how far away it is from the Bamboo Lounge. 3 blocks. They haven't told you the range on that cell tower. Blocks? Miles? So they showed you evidence that narrows Thomas Santasusa's location down to somewhere. But the fact is, only one witness claims that Thomas Santasusa went back to the Bamboo Lounge. Only one witness claims they saw Thomas Santasusa beat the victim bloody. Only one witness claims they saw Thomas Santasusa take a knife and stab William Caffier. Nick Patrick. And that brings us to the second problem with the Commonwealth's case. You can't trust Nick Patrick. You can't trust him because he's a career criminal. Extortion, narcotics, murder. The prosecution told you, well, today, he's telling the truth. Today, he swore to tell the truth. Members of the jury, this is a man who took the stand, looked you in the eyes, and admitted to being part of a murder. So what's a little perjury? You can't trust what Nick Patrick is saying today, because every time he's told his story, like he's told you, it changed. How the hell should I know what happened? I know exactly what happened. Only Tommy was beating him. Well, I got in a couple of kicks too. We only took a shove. On second thought, we may have grabbed a knife too. If you don't like one story, Nick Patrick's got another. You can't trust him because this is his only way out. Members of the jury, he admitted to conspiracy to commit murder. He admitted to being an accomplice to murder, but he's not going to spend a single day in prison for those crimes. But that's not even why he had to make this deal. Now, remember what you heard from the bartender. He heard Nick Patrick's boss telling him, the next time I catch you dealing drugs, there won't be a next time. Now, if most of us disobey our boss, we get a talking to. At worst, we lose our jobs. Nick Patrick was in the mafia. If you disobey your mob boss, you don't lose your job. You lose your life. That's what you heard from every single witness, including their own police sergeant. You're going to die. Your wife is going to die. Your daughters are going to die. Nick Patrick made this deal. He had three things in mind. His wife and his two daughters. Why does that matter? It matters because Nick Patrick had every reason to lie. And that's where we come to the third problem with the Commonwealth's case. Their own forensic evidence contradicts Nick Patrick. Let's start with the hands. Nick Patrick says that Thomas Santasusa beat the victim unconscious with his bare hands. There were no cuts on Thomas Santasusa's hands, no bruises. According to Nick Patrick, Thomas Santasusa had the victim's blood all over him. But when they collected those clothes, there was no blood in Mr. Santasusa's suit. No blood on his tie. No blood on his white shirt. Sergeant Rouse, she told you, well, must have washed him. If that's the case, why didn't she send those clothes to a forensic lab to test them for traces of blood? So let's talk about the car. Nick Patrick says Thomas Santasuso put the victim into the trunk of Nick Patrick's car. And then they both got in the car and drove away. Now, Thomas Santasuso's DNA isn't anywhere in that car. Not in the body, not in the trunk. But here's where it gets really interesting. Because Nick Patrick's DNA is inside the trunk of that car. The victim's DNA is inside the trunk of that car, but Thomas Santasuso's isn't. So they need you to believe that Thomas Santasuso was able to clean all of the forensic evidence that linked him to this crime, but leave Nick Patrick's there. Nick Patrick's story ends with a knife to the chest. Thomas Santasuso stabbing the victim over and over, and the police do find a kitchen knife with the victim's body. But there's no forensic evidence to link that to Thomas Santasuso. No DNA, no fingerprints. I told you, well, we don't need forensic evidence. We've got the knife block from his mother. Members of the jury, they told you that this knife came from this knife block. But they never even tried to prove it. No company, no measurements. They never even put that knife into the knife block to see if it fits. Think about that. They've had this knife in evidence for the last 2 years. And not once has someone thought, maybe we should see if the knife fits in that knife block before we prosecute a man for murder. Sevens, you can take that. You might have one final question. If Thomas Santasuso didn't kill the victim, who did? Well, the man who owed the victim $200,000. The man who has the victim's blood in the trunk of his car. The man who was last seen with the victim. Nick Patrick. If you're asking yourself, why would Nick Patrick want to kill William Cafiero? Well, it's because on the night that William Cafiero died, he had threatened Nick Patrick. He had told Nick Patrick that if Nick Patrick didn't pay up, he was going to go to Nick Patrick's boss and tell him Nick Patrick was dealing drugs. A threat that could get Nick Patrick killed. Members of the jury, if you believe that Nick Patrick committed this crime alone, you must find Thomas Santasuso not guilty. If you believe that Nick Patrick probably committed this crime alone, you must find Thomas Santasuso not guilty. If you think it's reasonable that Nick Patrick could have committed this crime alone, you must find Thomas Santasuso not guilty. That was their burden. Proof beyond a reasonable doubt. This is the verdict sheet. Right here. Ms. Evans, if you can pull it up, then I'll just finish without that. All right, members of the jury, soon you're going to be given a verdict sheet. It only has one question on it, guilty or not guilty. Oh, there we go. Because the Commonwealth has failed to meet their burden, you can check not guilty. Thank you, we can take that down. Like Ms. Stebbins told you at the beginning of this trial, there's no dispute about who Nick Patrick is. A mobster, a felon, a murderer. That's their only eyewitness. He's not here because he's telling the truth. He's here because it's his only way out. Find Thomas Santasusso, not guilty. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Wax. Any rebuttal argument?
Yes, Your Honor.
You may proceed.
Thank you. Now, the defense got up here today, and the first thing they told us was that Nick Patrick only had one choice. And since then, there's been a lot of mention of Nick Patrick and his past with drugs from the defense today. But members of the jury, William Cafiero didn't overdose on June 11th. He was beaten and stabbed 5 times. And let me just clarify, Nick Patrick is not on trial today, and here's why. See, Nick Patrick didn't get in a fight with William Cafiero at the lounge. The defendant did. Nick Patrick didn't say he was going to kill William Cafiero 3 times. The defendant did. Nick Patrick didn't go to his mom's house to get a knife. The defendant did. Nick Patrick didn't cut his GPS off before getting the knife from his mom's house. Again, the defendant did. And Nick Patrick isn't the one that held the knife and counted 1, 2, 3. The defendant did. And William Cafiero didn't say, Nick, please no. Nick, I've known you my whole life. He said, Tommy, please no. Tommy, I've known you my whole life. Because Nick Patrick wasn't the one standing over him with a knife. The defendant was. And lastly, Nick Patrick wasn't the one that stabbed William Cafiero 5 times in the heart. The defendant was. The defendant chose to do all of this. And that, members of the jury, is why the defendant is on trial today and Nick Patrick is not. That is why the defendant is guilty of first degree murder and Nick Patrick is not. All of the defendant's choices are why Nick Patrick was left with only one. To come in here and tell us what really happened on June 11th. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. And the case is submitted to the jury. Well done.
I'm going to leave the link to the ballot in the chat in case the judges are having trouble getting to it. And I just dropped it in the chat. So, Joe, I will let you know when all the ballots are in, and then we can begin comments.
All right. Sounds good.
Okay, I'm just missing Lorraine and Joe and Varghese. Varghese, there's a delay, usually a delay, so no worries. We're just waiting still. I'll let you know. Okay, we have everyone. We can begin comments. Since we have quite a few people, I would just ask that we limit it to one comment per team, per judge. Thanks, everyone.
I will pass it to our distinguished panel to begin.
All right, Lester, you're in charge. You tell us who's talking.
All right, let's go with Lorraine. You go first.
Hey, guys, how are you? I just wanted to say you could tell that everyone worked very hard and you really got into character, so you did a great job. So my critique is going to be the hardest on the prosecution team. I didn't love the 1, 2, 3 snap theme that you had. I mean, your case is more about did he do it or not, not whether it's first degree. Because clearly when you stab someone 5 times after beating them up and putting them in the trunk to go bury them, that's intent to murder. So I feel like your case was more about like, can you believe the co-conspirator who flipped and has motive to lie? So I feel like you could have done a better job in arguing why he's believable and what the corroboration was. And defense, I thought you did a really good job at pointing out the weaknesses in the prosecution case, and you know, not submitting the evidence for trace blood, the clothes for trace blood is really good. You probably could have used a little more animation, like acted a little more incredulous, like on TV, like what you didn't need to put that in, stuff like that. But you guys did a really good job, and I would have voted not guilty. That's all. Thanks.
All right. Ashley, if you'll give comments but not your verdict.
Sure. Just a couple general comments for both teams. These are things that I saw that could be adjusted generally moving forward in the further competitions that you guys do. You got to pull the sting during the direct examination. There were a couple moments that only worked well on cross because you guys chose not to bring them up in direct. It's really bad for you when bad facts are learned in the middle of a cross exam. So find a way to weave them into your direct so that you can be the one framing those bad facts. There were a lot of follow-up questions tonight on cross where so that's a yes and that's correct. And I think most of the time they were being asked not because the witness wasn't actually answering your question, but because you didn't like the way the witness answered, even though they were in fact answering with a yes or no. In fact, I believe at one point the witness gave an answer, ended with the word yes, and then the crossing attorney followed up with saying, so that's a yes, right? Because you didn't like the words that came before the yes. So take your time, and this kind of goes into my third point, listen to what the witnesses are saying. Just because they're not saying exactly what you want them to doesn't mean they're not answering your questions. And you got to pick and choose when to try to narrow them into a yes or no, and only use that tool when they're genuinely not answering your question. And then finally, asking to be heard on objections. Joe's a really attentive judge tonight, and he was asking for more information if he wanted more information. Your first time to talk on an objection, you should include all of the pertinent information you want to be heard in your objection. And your first response, you should include all that information. And then sit and wait. Unless it's really, really important for you, let the judge decide whether or not he wants more information, especially because tonight, most of the times when you guys ask to be heard again, and then Joe let you be heard again, the information you gave was either a rehash of what you'd already said or not really useful and wasn't very persuasive in changing the ruling to the objection. So be confident in your first answer, and then don't jump down the judge's throat to try to get another statement out. Let the judge decide whether or not he wants more information or not. Overall, though, this was really fun. I enjoyed it. And good job to both teams.
All right, Jordan.
Sure, I'll keep it brief because I think I might be one of the last things standing between this and dinner. I will say, not to rehash anything, I think what was very good to see was the amount of poise that was shown by everyone involved. On cross, if you didn't get the answer you wanted, trying to get that answer you wanted, but not necessarily being forceful about it in your tone, but still getting the end result. Also, the defense closer, when the verdict sheet did not come up, making a joke, keeping it light, and the use of technology throughout this, I thought was well done, well produced, we'll say, because it is a production, all trials are. So I was just happy to be here, and congrats to whoever comes out on top.
It's curious.
Thank you. I thought all four of you did a real nice job. Obviously, well-prepped your witnesses. Good job on cross-examination. The only critique I have is that, and I think somebody else already said it, is that sometimes you expected a certain answer, and it felt like maybe you didn't listen to the response and just jumped into your follow-up or looping question. And I thought if that could be cleaned up a little bit, it would be a little better. But I thought you guys all did a really nice job. I know it's super hard to do trials over Zoom. And then you guys should be proud of the job you guys did.
All right, Paul.
So I probably have less trial experience than most of the other judges, but a whole hell of a lot more experience writing mock trials than the other judges, because I've written the last 11 Pennsylvania cases and four of the last 10 national cases at the high school level. And I can tell you murders are fun and miserable because case balancing them is almost impossible. As many times as I did it, I think I've gotten it right once. And it's just hard. And so I don't think that a murder is always a fair fight. But there are different things that people mean by control. And I think that the mistake, to the extent that there was a mistake made, and again, echoing everything everybody has said, you guys did great, blah, 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 blah. You don't care about that part. If you haven't figured that out already, I can't do anything for you. I very much agree with Ashley and Varghese that the way that you had tried to assert control on cross-examination was like, no, you're going to give me a yes or a no. And that's actually a sign of weakness. It's actually a sign of vulnerability. You're showing like, oh, you got me. So now I've got to come back and like take that turf back from you. No, whatever. If you want to blither a little bit and then you give me my answer, great. Let's keep going. Let's keep cruising here because you're not touching me because I'm invulnerable. I control this space. So you can dance around a little bit and do your little this and that. But until you lay a glove on me, my blood pressure is never going up. And connected to that, a couple of times within that first couple of questions. The first couple of questions on a cross-examination are essential for establishing the control dynamic. And a couple of you who were in other ways exceptional in your efforts started out with the question that you wish you could get an answer to, but that you're not going to get an answer that's a yes to. And then you got sort of rolling around in the mud with the witness over what exactly you meant by this word or that word. Like, trust your closing argument. Cross is for facts. Go get the facts you need and leave it, especially if they're giving you 10 or 15 minutes to close. Like, when you only have 5 minutes to close, it's really tempting to try to like slide some of that into your cross-examination so you don't have to do it all in closing. But if you have an adequate amount of time to close, trust yourself. Go get the fact. And especially on those first 4, 5, 6 questions, when you're building that rhythm, when you're building that invulnerability of the attorney, do not give them an excuse to give you a no or I disagree or whatever. Make sure that the first few things out of their mouth, they're coming right along with you. Train them early and show the jury that you're in control. And then don't worry about the small stuff, because they're all going to yank on the leash a little. But unless they're breaking away, you still got the leash.
All right. Well, I know you're about, we're about to find out, you know, the verdict as to who's moving on, but or who's going to win. But both of you need to, both teams need to understand you've done what you set out to do for this competition. You maximized your opportunities to try this case. And that's what you want to do. You want to get as many cases and as much experience as you can. That's the purpose of these competitions, is to give you experience. And you guys maximize the experience. And we'll have, somebody's going to win, somebody's going to come in second. But You both did well, and there are 14 other teams that wish that they were here. And I think both of you showed that you were you definitely deserve to be in the finals. So thank you for letting me preside, and good luck to you moving forward in the future. I hope we never run into you in a trial competition. I hope this is all you do. I hope you're all retiring from trial. Probably not. Congratulations. And Phil, the show is yours.
Thank you, Joe. And before I get to the part that everyone's waiting for, just one more time, thank you so much to our excellent panel. I should say that Judge Perry had to sign off immediately after the round, after he submitted his ballot. He had something else he was late for, so I appreciate his time. And I appreciate everyone's time who signed on to judge this round. Just an excellent, excellent, excellent final panel. And this really was an excellent final round. And I can tell you who these teams are now that the tournament is over. Representing the Commonwealth was Team 107. That's Nova Southeastern Law School. And representing Team 116, representing the defendant, was UCLA Law. These two teams were excellent this tournament. And it goes without saying, I'm sure that's not surprising after you watched that round. These were two excellent teams that did very well in this tournament. They were the only two undefeated teams going into the fourth preliminary round. They were 9-1 in their trials coming into this round. They were 20-4 on ballots after the preliminary rounds heading into the playoffs. And so this really was just a clash of the Titans, and just a really excellent final round. I'm just so impressed every year with the quality of our championship rounds. It seems like they get better and better every year. This is the fourth Battle of the Experts. And so I'm very pleased to announce that our fourth Battle of the Experts national champion for the 2021 tournament and still champion UCLA. Congratulations, guys. And congratulations to Nova Southeastern on an incredible run. And you should be really proud of the way that you performed, not only in this round, but in the entire tournament. Thanks, everyone, for watching. We really appreciate those who tuned into the live stream and watched us. Hope you enjoyed yourselves, and we'll see you next year.